all are ready. Gayatri is there?
Yes, sir.
Anjani is there? Very good. Fantastic. So all of you turn your videos on. Okay, I didn't turn my video on, right? Now you will curse me. You are asking us to turn your video on and you are not doing that. Wait a minute. Yeah, I'm there. Okay, now all of you listen carefully, lend your ears. Okay, then how the presentation goes on, let me tell you. You need not share your PPT to the screen. Okay, you should share the PPT to all the group members, including me, today itself. Today 1 o'clock is the deadline. Okay, so today you share the PPT so that it will be available to all tomorrow. So we'll be accessing your PPT. You have to, we'll start with roll number one, Lehri. When roll number one is ready, then roll number two and three should also be ready on the screen. Roll number two and three. So who is one? Lehri. Lehri is here today?
Yes, sir. I have turned on my video also, sir.
Oh, good. Yeah. So tomorrow, first will be Lehri. Okay. Then after that, when Lehri is ready, Sirisha and Bhaskar, Hema and Lavanya should also be ready. Did you understand that?
Okay. Sirisha and Bhaskar means 64 and 63.
From frame exactly. Two and from the last two, sir.
Yeah, because Lehri, she doesn't have two students before her, no? So we are counting the last two. You got it? That's okay. The idea. When Lehri is doing, then Sirisha and Bhaskar before her will be ready. And Hema and Lavanya after Lehri will be ready. Okay. So how it happens is, when Lehri is presenting, we all should be attentive. So you take your own resources, but I want my student talking to the class. That the idea of presentation is that only. Okay. You should face the crowd. You should not be scared of the crowd. You should face the crowd. Okay, that is the whole idea. You will develop your communication skills. You will develop your public addressing skills, and you will feel strong with your subject, and you will avoid any kind of phobia. Your confidence builds. That is the basic idea. Okay, I wanted to impart knowledge into my student's mind, and the same knowledge has to be reflected in these presentations. That is my objective. I wish you all will fulfill that. I'm trying to do this. I wish you all will cooperate with this. Is it okay? Can you do this?
Yes, sir.
What do you say? Yes. If you have any problem, if you have any question, please ask me now itself so that tomorrow we can save our time.
Sir, okay? if that will be interactive sessions.
Exactly.
But the time consumption will be very high because we have seen the same issue in PAR. So
don't worry about it. Don't worry. I will take care of that.
Okay, sure.
Then okay. And thankfully, we don't have any session after presentation.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Yes, time sir. Is not a problem at all. I will take extra time, extra day also for that. I want my student to be so good. I think Vaishnavi, now we are okay. Vaishnavi okay. Mentioned Vinavasi. You're okay?
Okay, sir.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So please check your data balance. Check your Wi-Fi. Check your phone recharge, phone charge. Everything, get it ready. Okay? So that will prove to everyone that we are foolproof. We are budding managers. We take
good morning, sir. Sir, nature and scope of business economics.
Fantastic. So when you present this way, for example, Lehri will be giving a topic today. Then the following students should give the question. Arsha, if you are ready, can we do a small simulation here?
Sure, sir. I'm ready.
Yeah. So Harsha will be giving his topic in few minutes. Then others, please, once he finishes, you can put your questions. Okay? Please, you can start, Harsha.
Sure, sir. I'll just share my PPT.
Don't share. So mute yourself, all of you. I think whiteboard got opened. Please avoid all those things. Don't share your screen. Don't share PPT, nothing. You just talk.
Okay,
are you getting my point?
Yes, sir. Yes,
don't
sir,
think too much. You just talk whatever you want. That will do. So all of you, turn your videos on. Mute yourself. So that Harsha will feel that he is addressing people. Okay? He is addressing the crowd. Please, go ahead, Harsha.
Yeah. Good morning, sir. And good morning, all. My topic for today is corporate income, and I'm going to discuss what it actually is. So what is a per capita income? Per capita income is a subproduct of national income, which is measured amount of money earned by a person in a national or a geographical region. It is calculated by the dividing the country's national income by its population. So the basic concept is to understand the average income of a person in a country. Uses of the per capita income. The per capita income is the per capita income is calculated in a certain area of wealth or lack of wealth. The per capita income main uses is that. What is the wealth or the amount of resources which is utilized in a particular area or a region, which people are how much wealthy or how much rich in certain region and certain area, to calculate the income in certain area or a region is basically the concept of per capita income. For example, I'll take an example. So is Visakhapatnam is one region in Andhra Pradesh and in India. So in Visakhapatnam, there will be a per capita income matrix where by calculating the per capita income, we'll come to know that what is the wealth of the area and what is the standard of people people who live in Visakhapatnam to sustain their lives in Visakhapatnam, what is the standard of income they have to get to live in Visakhapatnam and to do business and to do investments and to do other financial related things. That's the basic idea and the basic concept of per capita income. So
Thank you, Harsha. Questions? Harsha, what is per capita income of India?
India, sir.
Financial year 2021.
Just a moment, sir. I think it's 1,30,000, sir.
1,30,000.
Yes, approximately 1,30,000 is the per capita income of India.
So, what is the source for that?
Sorry, sir.
What is the source?
Indian status.
Don't say Google. Google.
No, sir. I have seen that. Indian Statistics Council, I think, sir. I don't know the situation, but Indian Statistics Council, I think.
Okay, fine. So now you got it, all of you. Yeah. So the idea is the presentation will happen for 1 minute or 2 minutes or 3 minutes. You need not break your heads for that. Okay. Just some response. We put some question and Harsha gave some answers. Now, to what extent you are confident? That's what I'm looking at. Okay. Did you understand that?
Yes,
so
sir.
Tomorrow these things will happen. Please, if you cannot respond, if you don't know, say, I'm sorry, Manisha, I cannot answer your question. Sorry, Gayatri, I think this is what I mean for your question. You can respond. There's nothing wrong. That is how you have to develop your presentation or communication skills with the crowd. Don't be scared. Okay. don't be fearful. You should be strong enough. Okay. So I think tomorrow the whole day should go this way. Harsha, Veena, other participants, is it fine?
Yes, sir. Absolutely fine.
Yeah.
Yes,
time killing happens. Time killing happens when you're reading the PPT. Okay. When students are reading the PPT, even if I give the whole day, it's not sufficient. Please don't read the PPT at all. We have your PPTs with us. Okay. For example, Harsha PPT is there in the WhatsApp group right now. Okay. So before the presentation starts, you can read, or while the presentation is on also, you can read the PPT. You can know about his topic. So come to session with a very bold mind. Be honest. Okay. Be brave. Be confident. That is what I'm looking at. Okay. Stronger you are, full marks, 10 marks, full marks. Okay. If you are not strong, you may lose marks. Okay. Okay. Are you with me, all of you?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
With me, without me. With me, without me. It's up to you. Your choice. So I will test you tomorrow. Let us see how it goes on tomorrow. Okay. So please pass on the same to all your friends. And all of you, please let us have a sincere dress code. Have a nice attire. See, please don't face the camera like this. This is wrong. Maybe something opposite to the light will give you a good picture. You will be very bright. Okay. Yeah. Gayatri, you're right. Everyone is right. Harsha is right. Veena is right. And I wish all of you will have the same attire, same attitude, and make it a big success. Remember, all your presentations will be recorded. For best marks, follow my guidelines. Thank you. I wish you all the good luck. Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir.
Excuse me, sir.
And I wish you all the good luck, all the very best. Do well tomorrow. Bye-bye.
Bye, sir. Thank you so much.
My topic is microeconomics.
Yeah, please go ahead.
To learn about microeconomics, first you have to know what is economics. Economics is study of how people make decisions based on the scarcity and how limited resources are allocated to satisfy the want and need. It is also derived from the Greek word oikos and nomin, which is household and management. Economics is divided into two types. One is microeconomics and macroeconomics. Microeconomics were first used in microeconomics. Microeconomics derived from Greek word micros, which is small. Microeconomics is considered
no problem. Go ahead. Yeah. Hema, Bhaskar, Lahiri, or others, can you put quick questions to Lavanya? Ask some questions about microeconomics.
I will. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Microeconomics is concerned with the small unit of an individual and an independent firms and industries. Well, coming to the nature of microeconomics. Microeconomics is concerned with the market basis and their peaks and questions like what goods are to be produced with the limited resources and how these goods are to be distributed and with what sources these goods should be allocated. Well, coming to the scope of microeconomics is subdivided into three theories. theory of product pricing, theory of factor pricing, theory of welfare economics. So coming to the theory of product pricing, theory of product pricing focuses relative of prices of commodities to determine its price. Theory of price focuses on the demand and supply. We have to analyze the demand and supply to know the consumer's behavior and production cost of a firm and an individual. Well, coming to the theory of factors of production, theory of factors of production based on land, labor, capital, and entrepreneurship. Land earns rent, while labor earns wages. While capital earns profit. From all the above, entrepreneurship earns profit. While coming to the theory of welfare economics, it is based on the efficiency of allocation of the resources for the society. Thank you.
Yeah, questions?
Example for microeconomics.
Maybe practically, Bhaskar wants to know that.
Okay, Bhaskar, we can consider individual firms.
Okay. In your practical life, do you use microeconomics, Lavanya?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. That's it. Thank you very much, Lavanya. Guys, all of you listen to me carefully. All of you turn your mics on. You know the kind of efforts Lavanya has put. She lost her sister and today is 11th day. And she was insisting, sir, I will do it. I was asking her, I will take it later. No, sir, I will do it right now. That's the attitude a student should have. Hats off to you, Lavanya. A big round of applause to Lavanya. All of you, please. My whole life, I never saw a student like you, Lavanya. Everyone tried to give an excuse to run away from class or presentation, but you are the girl who came forward. No, sir, nothing will stop me. That's the spirit. I wish you all the good luck and be safe. I wish you are taking care of your family members. How is your mom and dad, Lavanya, doing? They're at home. They're close to you. They're nearer to you.
They are recovering, sir.
They are nearer to you. Can you show them to us, if possible?
There's schools are going on, so I can't.
Okay. Don't worry. We all are with you. Be brave. Be strong. The family needs your kind of a personality. You are a brave girl. All the very best. If you want something, please do not hesitate to call us. Okay?
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your spirits, Lavanya. Thank you. Yeah. I wish you all got some inspiration from Lavanya. I never saw a girl like that. You know, that's great. I'm so happy to meet a student like that. Thanks, Lavanya. Okay. Next, Lehri.
Good morning, sir.
Lehri, are you ready?
Yes, sir.
So, Lehri will be giving a topic. Yeah, please go ahead, Lehri.
Good morning, sir. My name is Sandhya and my roll number is 01 and my topic is of about nature and scope of business economics. First, we should know what is economics. Economics is a Greek word derived from the Greek word oikos and nomein, meaning a house and to manage respectively, referring to household management. It is a study of materialistic use of available resources and to get the maximum utility through optimum utilization in a rational way. There are three types of economics, sir. One is classical approach, neoclassical approach, modern approach. Coming to nature and scope of economics. First, definition of nature of business economics. Usually, business economics is normative in nature. It offers the suggestions to the application of economic principles in a making decisions and planning for the future and even the environmentally through established business rules. Coming to scope of management, business economics is the study of factors which affect the working management and prosperity of a business or firm. In this scope of business economics, the factors with the business as well as factors that beyond are the business owner's control. Coming to nature and nature of business economics. Nature of business economics always deals with close to microeconomics, normative statements, prescriptive actions, interdisciplinary based on assumptions, study of allocation of resources. Close to microeconomics, business economics is more concerned with microeconomics in decision-making situations of individual establishments. Therefore, it depends on techniques of management. Coming to normative statements, it describes the judgment oriented about which is right or which is wrong. Normative statements in this economics is of two types. Economics deals with two normative statements. One is positive and second one is normative. Positive is also known as pure science, which analyzes the cause and effect of relationship of a behavior. Coming to normative statements. Normative statements is a science. It involves the judgments given circumstances. Usually it is an individual or society of such behavior. Coming to the prescriptive actions. It depends upon prescriptive actions always go ahead on a function future goal oriented. Interdisciplinary actions. It deals with the firms, enterprises, individual, household management, and it also requires the management rules and principles to know what is the real world in the firms. And also it deals with all other subjects. It has a relation with other subjects based on assumptions. Economics is completely based on assumptions by preparing of future goals oriented, by making decisions, and by improving the individual firms, and so on. Study of allocation of resources. Allocation of resources always deals with W questions, whether what is input allocation, what is output allocation, what is fund allocation, and etc. Coming to scope of business economics. Scope of business economics deals with marginal analysis, demand theory, theory of production, theory of pricing policies, theory of profits, theory of capitals, analysis of market structure. Coming to marginal analysis, it is an analysis which helps to individual and business in balancing the cost and benefit of additional actions. Demand theory. In this demand theory, it refers to quantity of a commodity that the consumer able to have and willing to buy for each possible, which is required for a individual, is explained by demand theory. Theory of production. It explains the economic and efforts in to explain the principles and other all input and output factors are explained in this theory of production. Coming to theory of pricing policy. In this policy, it is based on relation between internal and external pricing policies. Coming to theory of profits. In economic profit, economic is completely a pure profit. In this, it manages the costs of management, insurable risks, and to maintain investments in current level. Coming to theory of capital. The traditional theory of capital structure states whether the weighted average cost is an optimal structure of capital exists or not. Analysis of market structure. Analysis of market structure is a great importance for buyers and sellers. Thank you, sir.
Questions, please.
So, have you explained about the theory of profits and theory of capital? Have you mentioned in PPT?
Yes, I mentioned.
I can say nature of business economics is descriptive or normative.
It is a normative. Example, firms, industries, small businesses, all.
Okay.
Can you define nature and scope of economics?
Yes. Usually, business economics is normative in nature. It offers suggestions to the application of economics principles for decision making and planning for the future. However, firms must understand whether the environment is normative or it is a nature thoroughly to the decision rules. And coming to scope of economics, business economics is the study of all the factors which affect working, management, and prosperity of a business or firms.
So, positive and normative theories application.
Application of positive theory, it describes the relation between the benefits. And coming to normative, it describes the relation between individuals.
Okay. Positive. Thank you, Lahiri. That was a good presentation. Good answers for four different questions from your friends. Thank you. All the best.
Thanks.
So next is Hema. Yeah. Hema, are you ready? With a smile.
To define what is original history, we should know what is economics. Economics is the dealing with the individual behavior and his decision making when there is a scarcity in the resources. There are defined by Alfred Marshall and Adam Smith. Adam Smith defined the wealth definition.
Hema, your voice is breaking, Hema. Can you be a little closer to mic or can you use earphones?
Prasad. No, sir. Prasad, you should you mute yourself.
Yeah, Prasad. All of you mute yourself when you question, you can unmute. Yeah. Go ahead, Hema.
Sorry, sir. There's a technical issue regarding this.
No, it is fine. Leela Prasad has muted. Go ahead.
Okay. So Adam Smith defined the wealth definition as wealth is one of the important parts of the economics. Where wealth is there, everything will be satisfied. Alfred Marshall again come up with a new definition that not only wealth, welfare should also be considered. On the other hand, where mankind is very important, wealth will give you satisfaction, where welfare will give you the mankind of the nature. And next, many definitions have evolved about the economics. Moving to history and origin of economics, I want to explain the origin of economics. Origin economics is originated from the Greek philosophers. First person to define economics is Plato. And Plato defined economics as economics is nothing but resources and property should be distributed equally in the common way. And next, Plato and Aristotle have defined economics as not only property and resources, human nature should also be understood in equal with that. And Adam Smith, after this is called classical approaches, and Adam Smith coming to neoclassical, he has defined economics as wealth, what I've discussed before. Wealth is the most important part of the human life, where the human is wealthy, he can satisfy all his wants and requirements, what he needs. Next comes to Alfred Marshall. Alfred Marshall has also defined that mankind is one of the important part of the economics. Man is treated equally with the wealth, where if man is good, he is going to consume the products what he wants. After that, Karl Marx and many of the economics has defined what economics is, and it has evolved from that 1776 in the 19th century. So this is the history of the economics, and I want to go to origin of the economics. Economics is originated from the Greek philosophers. And economics is the word derived from oikos and nomios. Oikos is the management of the resources. Oikos means the household, and nomios is the management of the resources. So when there is a scarcity of the resources, how to manage and how to utilize the resources in optimum way is the thing what economics defines as. So this is all about origin and history of the economics, and everything is same.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So that was a good narration about economics in derivation of definitions, going back to Aristotle and so on. Historically, that's a good job done. Yeah. Questions?
As you said, there are three theories of the economics, like classical, neoclassical, and modern. Can you shortly explain one modern economics in two or one or 2 points?
Hi, voice. I'm not getting your voice.
Okay. Next question.
Pardon me, please. I'm not getting her voice.
Hema? Hema? Alfred Marshall has described the economics. It is also known as? That definition is also known as neoclassical approach. He has given Alfred Marshall as the economics. It is also known as?
Oh, these guys have mastered the economics. Okay, good, good. Very good. Others?
Difference of any two theories. Theories are theories.
Okay. Thank you, Hema. This will speed up when you roll on. Okay? Fine. Next participant.
Yeah, me, Veena.
Veena, yeah. Veena is ready with the topic. Go ahead, Veena.
Good morning. My topic is micro versus microeconomics. First, what economics is actually? Adam Smith, who is the father of economics, defined the economics as the cause and the reason for which the wealth of the nations. And the economics is mainly classified into two types, like micro and the macroeconomics. The word micro is being derived from a Greek word micros, which means the small or an individual. It also the study of the independent or the micro units in the economy, like household, any firm, business. And where macroeconomics, micro, the word macro is being derived from a Greek word macros, which means large or in a group. It is the study of behavior of all the aggregates. And it is a study of the country's economic behavior in that out in terms of its production price or in its supply demand. And the examples like GDP, national income, inflation. And here coming to the differences between the micro and the macroeconomics, the basically the microeconomics deals with the individual economic variables, whereas microeconomics deals with the aggregate of the economic individuals, like the microeconomics, maybe the price of a single commodity. But here the microeconomics deals with the pricing of the general level, general pricing of any commodity. Microeconomics deals with the individual income. Macroeconomics deals with the nation's income. Microeconomics deals with individual output or the individual demands, whereas the microeconomics deals with the gross domestic products or the aggregate demand or the market demand. And when coming on the basis of central problems, price determination and resource allocation are considered in the microeconomics, whereas in macroeconomics, determination of full level income and employment, such as the price may be dependent on the supply and the demand. Has income in microeconomics, as income increases, the demand increases, the demand which in turn leads to the supply increases and which in turn leads to the price increases. But whereas in macroeconomics, we analyze the things like investment has to be increased, which in turn makes the industries to increase, where the employment of any nation will be increased, and the flow of as employment increases, the flow of goods and services in the market increases, which in turn finally increases the aggregate demand of any nation.
Veena, can you conclude? Time is up.
Yes, sir. Has both the, for any nation, the micro and microeconomics are mostly important, and microeconomics is used takes a bottom-down approach so that it makes the complex issues into small particles and so that it can be easy to resolve. Whereas in micro, we will be taking the top-down approach.
It's very difficult to stop, Veena. Okay, let's take questions quickly.
How influence affects the macroeconomics?
Sorry?
How inflation affects macroeconomics?
Inflation is an example of microeconomics, like the inflation cannot be taken for any individual, or it's the overall price change in the its living standards. So it can be considered as a whole.
Okay, next question.
Veena, simple difference between micro and macro?
Like for example, when we take any organization, like telephone sector, we take the Airtel, Jio comes under the microeconomics. The whole telecom sector comes under the macroeconomics.
Okay, next question.
Okay, can you give me a brief example about microeconomics, like in a business perspective? Like, can you give me an example about it?
Yeah, like any sectors, like when we take IT sector, the individual firms like TCS or Wipro, Infosys may consider as a microeconomics, but the whole IT sector is being considered as the macroeconomics. Like for example, in our college.
Okay, we got it. Aparna got it, we got it. Yeah.
No question, sir. I want to ask an example, but two of our numbers have asked them.
Okay, his audio is not clear. We'll stop it here. Thanks, Veena, for your rushing presentation. It was very difficult to stop you. Thank you. Good luck.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Next, Lila Prasad. Yeah. Are you ready, Lila Prasad?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Myself, Lila Prasad. My role number is 5. My topic is macroeconomics. Macroeconomics is the study of behavior and decision making of a whole economy. It describes how an economy increases their economic growth, employment, etc. It focuses on the more on economy as a whole, features of economy. There are many features. The study of aggregate, it focuses on aggregate as a whole. Macroeconomic studies national income, employment, inflation, etc. But that not focused on only individuals, it is focused on whole economy.
Okay, no problem. Go ahead. Take questions to Lila Prasad. That's better. Just say something if you have. Yeah, please give questions to Lila Prasad. He will answer. His topic is macroeconomics.
I'll give you example, Lila Prasad. If MBJR is one organization, can you consider Department of Management Studies can you consider it is as macroeconomic?
Yeah. In some cases, macroeconomic study of whole, total MBJR taken as a part is sometimes applicable to macroeconomics.
Okay, good.
I think.
Good. You're right. Yeah. Next question, please.
Any real-time example where we see macroeconomics?
Examples, I think macroeconomics describes national income, etc. Government always follows macro, uses macroeconomics to calculate anything.
Good. Very good. Next question, please.
The word economics is derived from which language?
Opportunity. Okay. Thank you, Lila Prasad. Though you got some doubts on your presentation, you did it. You accomplished it. Congratulations. Thanks, Lila Prasad. All the best. Yeah. Next is Aparna. Go ahead, Aparna.
My topic is I have to talk about the role of the managerial economist. An economist is a person who studies about the different things in the society, and it's small or big. He talks about.
Yeah, go ahead.
So he talks about the relationship between the resources in the society. So here I would like to talk about the managerial economist. He's someone who handles the situations in a corporate office. Like he has to he manages with his analytical abilities and skills to take major decisions in the organization. So it is pretty important to take a decision in the corporate world. So his role plays a very major role. So,
as a like managerial economist is someone who has to take the responsibilities of the organization, as he has to think twice before making any decisions, like investing in some like his shareholders, helping his shareholders to where to invest and where not to, and and he studies the economic patterns of macro level and analyzes the significance to the specific firms he is working in. He has to consistently examine the probabilities of transferring an ever-changing economic environment into profitable. So he has to analyze every situation, every situation that comes to him in the organization. So he has to handle it with a future perspective that the business has to grow and achieve heights in the society. So that's it, sir. I'm sorry. Thanks. I'm little nervous.
No, sorry, you did it, but sometimes you wanted to give more and you got stuck. So, yeah, questions?
Yeah. What makes a managerial economics a successful economic successful managerial economics? I mean, some qualities can you give?
He has to be very like analytical about it, like he has to think very like through every direction, like how is the situation is going to turn out. So he has to be more careful about it. So he has to have very like good managerial skills, handling everyone with equal respect. So he should also these are the main characteristics that managerial economists should have.
Yeah, next question.
How can someone describe that he is correct managerial economist? Means what are the quality? What is that specific trademark of managerial economist?
Specific trademark. So he has to like every decision he makes should be should be beneficial to the organization. I think to the firm. So the managerial skills should be good. I think that's the answer. Okay. I don't know.
Yeah, I think you are successful in getting questions, Aparna. There are more questions ready for you. Actually, I thought of asking you, but as time is short, thank you very much. That's a good presentation. Good luck.
Thank you, sir. Thanks so much.
Yeah, next. Anjani? Yeah, go ahead, Anjani.
Good morning. My topic is about relationship of business economics with other managerial functions. Firstly, business economics means how business uses its resources optimally. Means optimum utilization of resources in a business is called business economics. The main objective of business economics is to meet the needs of the business firm. And it mainly focuses on its economic issues, problems related to business organizations, management, and different strategies. Coming to relationship with managerial functions, business economics should have a relationship with other managerial functions like accounting, mathematics, statistics, human resource, psychology, computer science, marketing, and production. Coming to relationship with accounting, like business economics should have a relationship with accounting because it can keep a proper accounting records. It can know the expenses and incomes of the business. It can know how much profit or losses the business will get, and it can know the exact financial position of the company. And next, coming to relationship with mathematics, business economics, you have a relationship with mathematics because it can mathematics helps in development of different economic theories. It can analyze the deviations in the business like that. Coming to relationship with psychology, business economics should have a relationship with psychology. It has to analyze the taste and preferences of the customers, attitude of the customers. It should analyze it can know the consumer behavior towards the tastes and preferences. Psychology plays a very important role in business economics. Next, coming to relationship with production, business economics should should have a relationship with the production, like how much supply should be there, how much to be produced, about production function, supply function, cost of production, like that. And coming to relationship with statistics, relationship with statistics help business economics to make a better to make decisions. It can have the analysis of the past data and predict future and can make good decisions. And coming to relationship with human resource, business economics have relationship with human resources, it can help in selection process, how much employees should be recruited, how much wages should be given. It mainly focuses on the optimum utilization of the resources. And coming to relationship with computer scientists, as you know, computers change the world, it also changed the way of business economics. It helps in storing the data, it saves time, it can analyze the data, whatnot, everything can be done with computer science. And relationship with marketing, it plays a very important role in business economics because using marketing, we can make pricing strategies. We can we can make market structure. We can know the market structures and how much demand forecasting, like that. And conclusion is that by using all these functions, a business can have a better functioning and solve all the problems, and it will become a successful business. Thank you.
Thanks, Anjani. You touched all the managerial functions and linked economics to all the managerial functions. Good. Questions?
Anjali?
Yeah.
How consumer behavior affects in business economics?
The consumer taste may change from time to time, so that they have to adopt the changes and make the changes in their product which are needed to the customers.
Yeah. Any other question? Okay. Actually, I thought of asking Aparna. Now I want to ask Anjani. See, if a person want to become a manager of economics for a firm, okay, then he or she should be an MBA or master's in economics. He should be pure economics or pure management. What do you think?
Pure economics, sir.
But how he or she will understand management functions? Question you can give your view.
Economics means they need not have that much managerial skills. They need to know how the resources to be allocated, like that. No, sir.
Yeah, I think the answer is your topic only. He should be an economist, but he or she should have the idea of all the managerial functions, preferably an MBA grad kind of thing. Thank you. Good luck.
Thank you.
Good one.
Thank you.
Yeah. Next. Prajna?
Yes, sir.
Go ahead. Prajna.
Hey, sir. Myself, Prajna. And my role number is 8. My topic is about economic concepts. First of all, what is economics? Economics is a science of scarcity. Scarcity is the condition in which our wants are greater than our limits. Since we are unable to have everything we desire, we must make choices on how we will use our resources. In economics, we will study the choices of individuals, firms, and governments. And we have four types of economic concepts.
scarcity, supply and demand, cost and benefits, incentives. Scarcity explains the basic economic problems that the world has limited resources to meet unlimited wanted, and this reality forces people to make decisions about how to allocate resources in an efficient way. As a result of the scarce resources, humans are constantly making benefits and the incentives offered by different sources. And my second topic is about supply and demand. In supply and demand demands in economics, relationship between the quantity of commodity that producers wish to sell at various prices and the quantity that customers wish to buy in equilibrium, the quantity of a good supplies by producers equal to the quantity demanded by consumers. For example, when sources refers to the amount of goods that are available, demand refers to how many people want those goods. When supply of a product goes up, the price of the product goes down, and demand for the product can rise because it costs less. At the same point, too much of a demand for the product will cause the supply. As a result, price will rise. And supply and demand should reach an equilibrium. The amount of goods being supplied is the same as the amount demanded, and resources are allocated efficiently. And my third one is costs and benefits. Cost and benefits analysis, also sometimes called benefits cost analysis, is a process used to measure the benefits of a decision or taking actions minus the costs associated with taking actions. And benefits can also include intangible benefits and costs from a decision, such as employee may.
Prajna, since we are reading the whole thing, you can give your point. That will be useful for us.
Okay, sir. And
because we already have your PPT with us. I'm watching your PPT. Just summarize.
Okay, sir. In costs and benefits, we have calculated by dividing the proposed total cash benefits of a project by the proposed total cash cost of the project. And my third one is incentives. Incentives is also, we can say that incentives are who encourage the employees. Incentives are also known as recognizable incentives and compensative incentives. In compensative incentives, they charge everyone, and in recognition incentives, they allocate the people and they encourage their employees, and they encourage employees. That's all, sir.
Okay, good. Questions, please.
Examples of an economic model.
Economic model include the classical model, and it has limitations that need to be considered in any economic concepts.
Okay. Thank you, Prajna. That was a good one. But you need to build up, boost your confidence, believe yourself, little serious. Okay? So that you can do well in your exam also. All the best. Thank you. Yeah. Next, Nandini.
Yes, sir.
You're ready, Nandini?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Please go ahead.
Good morning, sir. My concept is about a cost concept. So, first of all, I would like to define the definition of cost. Cost refers to an amount paid or done to buy goods or services which can be satisfy our needs. So, okay, sir. So, in today's scenario, the main aim of an organization is to gain profits. So, the organization decision is a decision of minimizing profits based on the behavior of cost and revenue. So in the business economics, cost can be defined as the efforts or material and resources, risk incurred and goods and services. So in this cost concept, the first point is opportunity cost. Opportunity cost is a alternative, it's an alternative best way, alternative foregone, which we do not buy or which we let to go. Like for an example, if you spend time if you spend your time and money to going to a movie and you can't spend that time by reading a book, you can't spend money on something else. So this is the opportunity cost. And now it comes to the actual cost. Actual cost means it's nothing but a real cost. Like example, labor, material and machinery. So, and the third one is direct cost. So direct cost is a price that can be directly produced for a specific goods and services. Like in this direct cost, we can see an example as the direct labor, direct material, and rent for factory. So, and the fourth point is about indirect cost. Indirect cost is not directly accountable to a cost. Like it is either a fixed or it is either fixed or variable. So now it comes to the fixed cost. Fixed cost means which we do not change with increasing or decreasing in a certain amount of goods and services produced. Like a fixed cost is nothing but taxes, electricity bills, and etc. So now it comes to the variable cost. So variable cost is an equal to the fixed cost. Means if products and sales are increases, then the variable cost also increases. And the examples of a variable cost is purchase of raw materials. And now it comes to the total cost. Total cost is defined as the total fixed cost plus total variable cost. Another one is sunk cost. Sunk cost means the money which we already spent, which cannot be recovered, means which it cannot be refunded. So, and the next one is average cost. Average cost means it is obtained by dividing the total cost by the total quality, quality of the output. So it's nothing but AC equals to TC by Q. So now it comes to the marginal cost. Marginal cost means it is an extra unit. So means we can define as an amount increased in the production of one additional unit. So thank you, sir.
Yeah, that's a good one. Nandini, questions please quickly.
Can you say an example of sunk cost?
Yeah, even I wanted to ask that.
Okay. Sunk cost, sunk cost, again, I will say the definition. Means the money that we already spent, which it cannot be recovered. Means example is, if you research a new product in the market and you left with nothing, means you have not gained any product. So that money you can't be refunded. So that is called sunk cost.
Thank you, Nandini. That's a confident presentation, confident response to the question asked by Anjani. Good. Keep up the spirits. Continue in the same way for the rest of the semesters also. Thank you. Please. So next, Akhil. Are you ready?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Fine. Go ahead, Akhil.
Sir, yeah. My name is Akhil, and the concept given to me is the profit concept. And the concept of profit entails several different meanings. The profit may mean the compensations received by the PIM.
Yeah, go ahead.
You're audible. Go ahead.
Okay, sir. The profit means the compensation received by the PIM. by for its managerial functions, and it is called as normal profit, which is a minimum sum of essential for the firm to remain in the business, and the profit may look locked upon as the reward of reward for the managerial entrepreneurial functions, and it is a reward earned by the entrepreneur for bearing its risks, and it is termed as super normal profit analysis. So the profit has six different types of and concept of profit has six different types of profits, like gross profit, net profit, accountable profit, and economic profit, and normal profit, and super normal profit, sir. And the gross profit is nothing but the profit that subtracts the cost of goods and selling goods, sir, selling products, like selling goods that the company makes the subtract the cost associated with making and selling its products, sir. And the net profit is nothing but amount of money left after the subtraction of total business expenses with the total revenue collected, sir. And the total revenue minus and total business expenses equal to net profit, sir. Then accounting profit, sir. Accounting profit is nothing but the implicit explicit of explicit cost, like the interest, taxes, the explicit is cost, and the economic profit is nothing but the owner assets, sir. The owner assets which are used for the business or firm is called as economic profit, sir. And the normal profit is nothing but what the profits we are predictable. Super normal profits are what which are not predictable, sir. Like we are having more profits on super normal profits. That's it. Thank you. Okay, any questions?
Yeah.
Anyone have any questions?
Faster,
okay,
please.
Then tell me, what is gross profit? Your question only.
Gross profit.
Okay. Don't say nothing but he said already. Okay.
Gross profit. Gross profit is a profit that subtract from the cost of the goods. Products of the goods and the selling of the goods. That is called the gross profit.
Good. Any other question? Fine. Thank you, Akhil. Though you are little lost here, somehow you could stitch everything put together and you made the show. Thank you. It was successful. All the best.
Thanks.
Next, who is it?
Morning, sir.
Good morning, Maithili. Are you ready?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, good. Go ahead.
Okay, my topic is about law of demand. Firstly, what is demand? Demand is nothing but the desirable to pay, ability to pay, desire to purchase, and willingness to spend. And then where it comes to the law of demand, So can I start again?
Go on.
The law of demand expresses the functional relationship between the prices and the quantity. It is universally observed that people buy more quantity of goods when they are available in the lower prices than the higher. And it when prices increases, the commodity decreases. The commodity demand decreases. When the price is lower, the commodity. Sir, I just want some time. Can I come back again?
No, finish it off.
Okay.
You're doing good. You're so good. What is your friend? Is she doing good or not?
Yes, sir.
Tell her.
I'm a bit nervous. Okay, I will complete it.
Yeah, please go ahead. Yeah, go.
It is necessarily, it is universally observed that the people buy more quantity of goods when they are available at lower prices than the higher. And it is the relationship between the price and the commodity is inversely proportional to each other. And the characteristics of law of demand are general tendency. The law indicates the general tendency which engages the quantity demanded with the changes in prices. And then the relationship between the time, the law of demand always related to the time, because the prices change from time to time and they are never fixed. And then prices, price and demand relationship, the price increase or the decrease, the price does affect the quantity demanded at the particular time. And then next, the expectations, the assumptions, the law of demand assumptions that the no change in price and price related to commodities in income of the consumer, taste and preferences, habits and fashion of the consumers, size and population, expectations regarding the future prices, and then the expectations and the limitations. Inferior goods, a fall in prices of inferior goods is to reduce the demand and raise in its price. And then the goods having prestigious value, where the goods like diamond and jewelry, cars, the consumers measured it as, means it, they take as a status, they treat as a state, means a, they use them as a status symbol, and then change in income, change in fashion, necessities. That's it. So I just want to conclude here. Thank you.
That's a very good one, Maitri. Actually, you spoke for yourself and you did it for yourself. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Any questions?
How come expectations and future predictions can change the demand?
Expectations and future demand can change. Like the commodity is never the same. I think so.
Yeah, okay. Other question? Look at Akhil. He's frozen actually. He looks frozen. Huh? Okay. Thank you very much, Maitri. Actually, I should tell you, you should start believing yourself. Okay. You're so good. You're doing so good. But a kind of pessimism is there. Okay. You're trying to shy away. Don't do that. Okay. You have to time has come that you have to believe yourself. You're solid. You're foolproof. Okay. Only thing is believe yourself. All the good luck for your future efforts.
Thank you, sir.
Next.
Sir, good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Okay, sir. And my name is Harkan. Going to.
I can't see you.
I think you have a technical issue. Just once.
Your signal is okay.
Signal is okay, Harkan.
Or shall we take it later? Sir. Because can you try with some other phone or some other signal? I will give you time. You can join later.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Okay,
Anusha,
sir.
Arshini.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, 15. Arshini, go ahead. You change your background, Gayatri. Yesterday it was so good. I was just joking. Yeah, go ahead, Arshini.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
So today my topic is elasticity of demands and its types. Coming to elasticity, it can be defined as a measure of variable sensitivity to change in other variable, and the sensitivity is change in a price which is related to change in other factors. And from a business and economic point of view, it is measured of how sensitive an economic factor is to another. For example, changes in the price of supply or demand or changes in demand to changes in income. Examples of elastic goods are some clothing and electronics. And inelastic goods includes items like food, and it is used to measure the change in quantity or demand of goods or services when compared to the price movements of those goods and services. And coming to elasticity of demand, elasticity of demand is having very important aspects in economic theory, and it is a change in demands. The demand constructs or extends with a rising or fall in prices. The quality of demands is elasticity of demands when the change in its and the prices changes low or high. And the types of elasticities are price elasticity, cross elasticity, income elasticity, and advertise elasticity. So price elasticity of demand, it is defined as responsiveness and sensitivity of a particular product along with the changes in its price. It shows the relationship between the price and quantity that provides of a price affects in price quantity of demand. And there are different types in price elasticity of demand. Those are perfectly elastic demand, perfectly inelastic demand, relatively elastic demand, relatively inelastic demand, and unitary elastic demand. Coming to income inelasticity of demand, it is one of the factors that influence the demand for a product, and the degrees of responsiveness of a change in demand for the product of the change in demands for a product due to change in income is also known as income elasticity of demand. Coming to cross elasticity of demand, it defines as a change in the quantity of demand for one commodity to the change in quantity of demand to other commodity is called cross elasticity of demand. Coming to advertising elasticity of demand, it is defined responsiveness of change in demand to change in promotional expenses is known as advertising elasticity of demand. The conclusion is
she already concluded, but she's extending what to speak. Yeah. Questions?
Any questions?
Calm down, cool down. Yeah.
Harshini, what are the factors affecting elasticity of demand?
Sorry, I didn't get you.
What are the factors affecting elasticity of demand?
What are the factors influencing elasticity of demand? Get the expression. Okay. Any other question? Okay, Harshini, we don't want to stress you further. You did so good. Again, like I told Maitri, I believe, you need to build confidence. Okay? The presentation was good. I don't know whether you read it or you spoke for yourself. The presentation was good. But at the end, you're worried what question will be answered, what else should I say kind of thing. Okay? Come out of those small factors, you will do wonders. Okay? All the best. Next.
Good morning, sir. Good morning, everyone. This is Gayatri. My topic for presentation is price elasticity of demand. Price elasticity of demand is defined as measurement of change in demand with respect to the change in price. There are five types: price elasticity of demand, relatively elastic, relatively inelastic, unitary elastic, perfectly elastic, and perfectly inelastic. Relatively elastic means with a small change in price, there is a huge change in demand. Relatively inelastic means with a large change in price, there will be a small change in demand. Unitary elastic means the change in price and demand will be same. Perfectly elastic means with no change in price, demand keeps on changing. Perfectly inelastic means whatever be the change in price, whatever may be the change in price, demand will not change. Yes, sir. Next, factors influencing the price elasticity of demand. First one is the nature of goods. Nature of goods means there are like necessary goods, comfort goods, and luxury goods. If we consider less necessary goods, they are less elastic. Comfort goods are moderately elastic. Luxury goods are more elastic to change. Next is availability of substitutes. If there are more number of clothes substitutes, the elasticity will be more. Income level. Next one is income level. Elasticity of demand of a commodity is less for higher income.
Gayatri, yes. We know we are strong in concepts. So we'll do one thing. We'll give you the questions. Is that okay?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Friends, questions. Harshini. Shoot. Question Gayatri. She was questioning, you know, tit for tat. You also question.
Sir, you asked me two questions, sir.
Arey, yaar, I'm just joking. Why you guys take it seriously?
No, sir, nothing serious. Like, it's not like tit for tat. I'm ready to answer.
No, I'm saying Harshini.
Uh-huh.
At least she can say. An opportunity, Harshini. Okay. Gayatri.
Yes.
Alcohol prices, whether they go up or come down, the demand is same, or demand is increasing actually. What kind of elasticity you call it as?
Alcohol prices, whether?
Like I given you example of a different good. Okay. Alcohol prices, yes, whether they're increasing or decreasing.
Okay.
The demand remains same, or the demand increases. So what kind of elasticity is it? Is it unitary? Is it perfectly elastic? Perfectly inelastic? Or inelastic? Elastic.
Sir, relative.
Relatively elastic?
Sir, relatively elastic, sir.
Okay. Any other question? Okay. Thanks, Gayatri. I thought a little different from Gayatri, but there is some knocking from you. Maybe next time I'll take care of you. Thank you, Gayatri. Good luck.
Thank you.
Yeah, next, please.
Good morning, sir. My name is Hima Bindu, and my topic is law of supply. And first of all, what is supply? Supply refers to quantity of product that firms are willing to offer for sale in the market at a different prices. And there are some aspects in the supply. Supply is desired quantity. Supply is always explained with reference to reference to price, time during which it is offered for sale, and next law of supply. Law of supply is the relationship between change of price and change of supply. if price increases, the quantity of supply is also increases. If price decreases, the quantity of supply is also decreases. Here quantity responds in the same direction as price changes, and the assumptions the law of supply assumes that there is no change in technology, goal of firm, and government policy and price should not change, and these should not change. And technology means a change in technology also affects.
Imamindu, can you summarize? You can see your PPT instead of reading. No, can you summarize?
No, sir. I'm prepared.
Oh, very good. Very good. I was just checking that. Can you summarize?
Yes.
Or can you take questions?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah. Questions?
Yes, sir. How expectation for future prices affects the law of supply?
Did you hear that, Gayatri?
Yes, sir.
Repeat the question.
How expectation for fixed prices affect the law of supply?
Respond, Himabindu. Ashwini, you want to answer? Okay. Thank you, Himabindu.
Thank you, sir.
Prepare well for your examination. All the best.
Thank you, sir.
Next, Pravalika.
Good morning, sir.
Yeah, please go ahead, Pravalika.
Sir, my topic is about determinants of supply. Determinants of supply means the factors that cause the change in the quantity of the supply. And as you see in my second slide, I have represented the diagram. And before going into the factors affecting the supply, I would like to say what is a supply. Supply means the relative term which refers to the price and time. It means if the statement which does not refer price and time, it does not make a economic sense. Supply means the products which we sell at a particular time with particular price is known as a supply, and the role of the organization is to organize scarce resources to make the supply in a profitable way. And when coming to the factors, price is the main price of the product is the main effective factor of factor affecting in the supply, and it is the starting point of the building model of the supply. And when non-factors supply, in that we have different kinds of factors. In that, the ability of the factor of the production, for example, raw materials and labor can affect the amount of the supplied and produced. And next is about the cost factor. The change in the cost of the supply will do some calculations to how much we have to supply at a given price. And another factor which affecting the supply is the tax, the value added tax of the product will affect directly, and the indirect taxes will affect indirectly to the supply, and it may affect the producer's decision how much to supply, and whether is also one of the factors affecting to the supply at the time of the production, and still subsidies is the funds given to the firm when it reduces the supply and increases the price of the product.
Okay. Any questions? What are the factors influencing supply, Pravalika?
Factors influence supply. Is there are many factors. In the major affecting factor is the price, sir. If the cost of the production is reduced, then we we can increase so our
supply price so that we can earn. When price is high or low?
Supply is increased when price is high and we can earn more profit, sir.
Okay, very good. Thank you. That's a good, confident presentation. Keep up the spirits. All the best, Pravalika.
Thank you, sir.
Next, Gautami. Yeah, go ahead, Gautami. Hey, we can't hear you, Gautami. Your mic looks like on. Mic is not visible. Mute your mic once. Mute and unmute. Yeah, unmute right now.
Hello, sir. Can you
hear me? Yeah, now we can. Why can't you use earphones?
Sir, my earphones
are
working.
But you're not audible to us.
So now? Now is it okay?
It's better, yeah. Now we can now hear you.
Okay.
Yeah, it's again gone. You do one thing, check out your technicalities along with Akhila, you can mute again. Check your technicalities, yeah, use the microphone or whatever. It's not audible at all. Can you hear, friends?
Yes, sir, I can hear you.
Can you hear Gautami? Venkat?
No, sir.
No, sir.
Because it is getting recorded, it has to be, it should be audible, Gautami.
Sir, now?
Keep talking.
Sir, now is it okay?
Yeah, now it's audible. Yeah.
Okay. My topic is elasticity of supply, sir. Elasticity of supply means it talks about how supply is getting affected due to the fluctuations of market prices. So it gives idea about profits made by the producers or sellers who are selling those commodities or products at their price differences. So elasticity of supply, it measures the responsiveness of quantity of supply to the changes in its price of the commodity. And the major factor which affects or controls the flow of supply is price. So we call it as price elasticity of supply. So the formula for price elasticity of supply is percentage change in quantity supply, percentage change in price. So there are 5 different types of elasticity of supply. They are perfectly elastic supply, perfectly inelastic supply, relatively less elastic supply, great elastic supply, and the last one is unitary supply. So first of all, when we talk about perfectly elastic supply, it tells that though there will be changes in the supply, whether it may be increasing or decreasing, there won't be any change in the price. That means the sellers are willing to supply their products or supply their commodities at the higher prices, and the elasticity of supply at these type of commodities will be infinite. If the small fall in price, it leads to supply becomes infinite. Supply becomes zero. If there will be small increase in the price, then it leads to supply infinite. So this seems that there will be no change in the price irrespective of the supply. And the graph of this curve will be parallel to the x-axis. And next comes perfectly inelastic supply. Perfectly inelastic supply talks about there will be no change in the supply even though changes in price takes place. So the curve of this type of commodities will be this right in parallel to y-axis. And next comes relatively less elastic supply. This seems that when the change of
supply is relatively less when compared to the change of price, then such type of commodities are called relatively less elastic supply. And elasticity of supply for such type of commodities will be less than one. And next comes relatively greater elastic supply, means when the change of price is less when compared to the change of supply. That means the change in supply is more when compared to the change of price, then such type of commodities is called relatively greater elasticity. So the elastic supply for such type of commodities will be greater than one. And next comes unitary elasticity supply. And here the change of price will be equal to the change of supply. Then such type of commodities is called unitary elasticity. So the elasticity of such type of commodities will be equal to one. And there are few factors like time factor, nature of the commodity, techniques of production, and risk taking. All these are the factors which affect the elasticity of supply. And few points which to be considered, like how this concept is helpful. Like it is helpful in taking better decisions in the business, and it determines the terms of trade between the two countries, and it all determines the factors of production. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, any questions on behalf of Gautam? Can you give an example of a perfectly elastic supply function?
Yes, sir. For example, if we consider the production of apples, so the overall for overall production, if the farmer spends 100 rupees for total production, for example, so he'll definitely try to sell those products with that 100 or above 100, but he won't sell below the price.
Okay, thanks Gautami, that was a confident presentation. You manage your technical issues also, and you got loads to give, but as the time is not sufficient, you did well. Very good. All the best.
Thank you, sir.
Next, Bhagyashree.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
My topic is about demand and supply curves. About demand. Demand is the quantity of a good that the consumers are willing and able to purchase at various prices at any time. Supply.
Your friends have already given about demand, supply function, and so on. Just give a talk about supply curves and demand curves and so on. Okay.
Okay.
So that we can save some time. Yeah, go ahead.
Demand. Now about demand curves. Demand curves gives the relationship between demand and the price of the commodity. There are five types of demand curves. First one is perfectly elastic demand. Second one is perfectly inelastic demand. Third one is relatively elastic demand.
Right? You want demand curves. Talk about demand curves. What is the slope of a demand curve? What is the slope of a supply curve? That's your topic, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you have to talk about the curves. So you didn't prepare for that.
No, sir.
Okay. Now let me tell you, demand curve is all about the relationship between quantity demanded and change in price. Okay. And demand comes down, when price comes down, demand increases.
Demand increases.
When price increases, demand decreases. Oppositely, supply. Price increases, supply increases.
Supply decreases.
So they go in opposite direction. So there will be an intersection of demand and supply. That's the idea. So I wish, please go through it once again. You should not be lost here.
Okay?
Okay, don't feel bad. You can spend some time on this. Do well.
Okay.
All the best.
Thank you.
Next, please. Venkat.
Yes, sir. Good morning, sir. Good morning, all of you.
Good morning. Yeah. Go ahead.
My topic is production function. My topic is production function. It is a in simple word, production function. Sir, just wait, sir. I will.
Gautami and Bhagyashree, please stay back.
Sir, just one second. I have called declining it.
Go ahead, Venkat.
Sir. Okay. Am I audible, sir?
Yeah. Perfect.
Yeah. Okay. So Vicky is calling. Just wait, sir. Okay.
Please switch on. Do not disturb mode in your phone.
Okay.
Flight down and switch on. Do not disturb mode.
Flight mode and approve.
Not flight mode. Do not disturb mode.
Okay. Just wait. Okay, afterwards I will take. Yeah, it's not. Okay, we'll continue.
Tell him whether he is audible or not.
Yes, sir. He is audible.
Yes, sir.
Tell him. Tell Venkat.
In simple words, production function refers to the function relationship between the goods producer and the goods and the factors of production in a company. The production function is a purely technical relation which commands factors, inputs, and output of the company. In this way, the production function reflects how
look
much
at the camera, Venkat. Yeah, look much? At the cam.
Okay, sir.
Not the PPT or the notes.
How the output we can expect from we have much in
really
labor.
He's looking down, see how smart he is. Okay, we will do one thing. What is your topic?
Production functions, sir, and types.
So what are the factors of production?
The factors means don't know, sir. Sorry, sir.
Arre yaar, you didn't prepare. Okay, maybe okay. Some other time I'll try to take it. Do it later, okay?
Yeah, okay, sir.
Yeah. Next.
Good morning, sir. Hi, sir. And my topic is about law of diminishing returns.
Law of diminishing returns. Good. Go ahead.
The law of diminishing returns is also known as the law of variable proportion. And according to the Samuelson definition, an increase in some inputs related to other inputs will cause the output to increase. Well, after a certain stage, it will result in an increase in the input. The output will remain decrease. Hello?
Yeah, go ahead.
Hello. Yes, which means if one input in the production of a commodity is increased, keeping all the other factors constant, well, after a certain point of time, though there is an increase in the input, the output will start diminishing. And margin utility, which means by adding one input, how much output will increase? This is the, we call this as the marginal utility. And the product and the total product of a production unit can produce using a different combination. Using a different combination of factors of production and the marginal product where extra output can be determined resulting from adding one input to an existing combination. And here we can take the example of the farmer who cultivates the rice in the 3x field. When there is only one farmer, the total product was 45 and the marginal product was 0. When there is an addition of extra farmer, that means 2, the total product increased from 40 to 55 and the marginal product has increased from 0 to 15. And by keep on adding, the total product also keep on increasing and the marginal product also increased up to the four farmers. Then the marginal product started decreasing though it is increasing, but it is decreasing at the percentage of increasing has the stage of 9th, 8th farmer. The total product of the 7th and the 8th farmer remains constant, 145, and the marginal falls to 0 and minus negative, minus 10, minus 15. And this there are three stages in the law of diminishing returns: the stage of increasing returns, stage of diminishing returns, and the stage of negative returns. From the stage 1 to 4, this is known as the increasing returns. At the increased and the marginal product also increased, but at the 5th to 8th stage, the total product also increased and then slowly decreased. The total product increased up to 8, and from 8th onwards it decreased. The marginal product increased at the diminishing rate, and from 9th and 10th the total products also increased and the marginal product became negative. This stage is known as the negative stage. That's it, sir. Thank you. Any questions?
Yeah, Sneha, can you give another name for this law of diminishing returns?
Yeah, the one name is law of variable proportion, and the other is the principle of diminishing marginal productivity.
Okay. Thank you. That was a smooth flow presentation with no mistakes or pauses. Fantastic. Very well done, Sneha. Thank you. Next, please.
Good morning, sir. I'm Lamia. And today, the topic for my presentation is market and types of market.
Just a moment, Lavanya. Please, yes. I'm repeating again and again. Following two and previous two, please stay on. This is killing time. If you follow my instructions, we can finish on time. If not, we have to stretch it to afternoon and evening also. Let us make it faster. Okay. So when Lavanya is talking, Harita and Prasad should be on. Similarly, Sneha and Venkat. Venkat, are you there?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, please. Every time I'm repeating this, because of this, the time is getting killed. Sooner we finish, sooner we can leave. Okay. Please go ahead.
Yes, sir. First of all, market is defined as it is a place where buyers and sellers will meet in order to sell and buy the goods and the services. That means the goods and services will be exchanged between buyers and sellers. Here, the buyers must have a potential capacity in order to carry on the transaction which they will be involved in. So, basing on the divisions, there are many types of market, but I have mentioned some of the few important types of market based on size, competition, and time. The first one is market on the basis on size or place. The markets are divided into the following. The first one is local market. A local market is the one where we will be going on in our day-to-day life. It is the market in which the perishable goods will be sold. And the next one is national market. This is the market where the goods and services are sold only within our country. The exports and imports from one country to another country is not carried out in this market. And the third one is international market. It is quite opposite to national market, where the goods and the services will be exported or imported from more than one country. So these are the divisions based on size. And the next one is the markets are divided into the following based on time. First one is very short period market. This market generally exists from days to weeks. The best example is the vegetables, flowers, fruits will be sell in this type of market. And the next one is short period market. This is the market which usually lasts from 3 months to 6 months. And coming to the next one, short period, long period market. This is the market which lasts for 1 year to 5 years.
And the last one is very long period market. This is the market which will be permanent in nature or in a country, and it will usually last for more than 5 years. And the last one is the markets are divided into the following based on the competition. The major criteria for this division is the first one is perfect competition market and the imperfect competition market. Coming to the perfect competition market, it is the situation where there will be fixed price will be there in the stack of market, and there will be more number of buyers and sellers. Coming to the imperfect market, it is also quite opposite to the perfect competition market. Here there will be no fixed price, and there will be no freedom for entry and exit. There will be many under imperfect competition market, such as monopoly. In this, there will be only one seller producing homogeneous or differentiated products. And the next one is duopoly. Two sellers will be there in this market. And the next one is oligopoly. A few sellers and the buyers for the homogeneous or differentiated product. And monopolistic competition. Here also, there will be more number of buyers and sellers. So these are some of the types of market.
It seems you are unstoppable. We can't stop you. You are so good at rushing. So good. Very good. Take questions, I suggest.
Okay. Can one ask question for my presentation?
Look at the expressions.
Lavanya, examples of oligopoly market.
Oligopoly market means first of all, it is defined as few sellers and buyers, right? So the vegetable markets or the fruit markets can be said as it can be said as the example of oligopoly market.
I don't think we have doubts or questions for you, Harita. Like was praising Sneha, you're also like that. You're continuously flowing. You're not stopping at all. Good, very good. Maybe the roll number, neighboring numbers are influencing each other. Just so good. Thank you.
Thank you.
All the best.
Thank you.
So next.
Excuse me, sir. Sorry for interruption. Actually, I'm Lavanya. I have completed. Next one is Harita should complete her presentation.
I'm sorry.
Okay, sir.
So Harita will be doing now, followed by Sravanya, right?
Yes.
Yeah, good.
Yes, sir.
Regrets, Lavanya.
No, sir, no problem. Sir. Yeah. Thank you.
Lavanya and Sneha, stay back. Yeah, go on.
Good morning, sir. My name is Harita. My presentation topic is perfect competition market. A market is a place where two or more parties engage in exchange of goods and services, and it's a place where sell the products and the buyers exchange of money. And there are four types of market structures. And monopoly is the market where only one single seller will be there, and there are many buyers. Here the price can be fixed by the retailers. And then coming to perfect competition, there will be a large number of buyers and sellers, and there is no one big seller which will influence the market. And then coming to oligopoly market, they influence the market price and which they profit. To monopoly, they do not sell as products. Here is one product. And then coming to features of perfect competition market, a large number of sellers here, single sellers cannot influence the market, and sellers are the price goes. And coming to homogeneous product, identical products, the same cost, they directly free entry. That means a new firm can enter into the market. They can exit if they want, and there is no government restrictions. Buyers can have complete the information about the product regarding their cost, and then coming to their price takers. It means a firm or an individual who takes the market price as it given, and then coming to equilibrium in market. Your price is determined by the intersection of market demand and market supply. Here for individual, it is the demand curve is equal to the equilibrium price of the market.
Instead of reading the whole thing, take the question.
Okay, sir.
Because we have your PPT with us. Yeah, questions.
Harita, what is the difference between perfect competition and monopolistic?
Your perfect competition has large numbers and fellows, where monopoly there is only one fellow, and in a perfect competition there is no one big seller can influence the market, whereas in monopoly there are different the number of sellers.
Okay, thank you Harita, but I suggest you practice without looking at the sources. Okay, that will give you loads of knowledge. Okay, all the best. Yeah.
Okay.
Next is Prasad is absent. Sravanya, you're ready?
Good morning to one and all. My topic is duopoly. There is two words, duo and poly. Duo means two, poly means sellers. The duopoly means it has two sellers. The duopoly is a kind of oligopoly, a market which is dominated by a small number of firms. In the case of duopoly, a particular market or industry is dominated by just two firms, is widely known as the duopoly. In very cases, this means there are only two firms in the entire number of market. This means the duopolistic firms, they have great deal or influence in their actions, as well as the relationship between each other powerfully shape the industry. The duopolistic markets are imperfectly competitive, so entity barriers are typically significant to attempting to enter into the market, but there are usually still other small business persisting along the two dominant firms. There are some examples of duopoly. First one is smartphones. We all know Apple and Android. This plays a crucial role in the duopoly. Next, electronic payments. We have MasterCard and Visa. This also plays a crucial role in duopoly. Next, coming to soft drinks, Coca-Cola and Pepsi. Coca-Cola and Pepsi also have a dominant, they have a crucial role in the duopolistic market. Next, the advantages of duopoly. With significant competitors, the firms are able to generate the significantly higher profits practically. The consumers must nearly always choose one of the two. Next, the market is very simpler for customers, so they do not have search among the dozens of options to choose the best products for their needs. Next, the financial resources can be put forward in refining the quality and functionality of existing products and services, rather than attempting to create new one in order to be more competitive. Next, coming to the disadvantages of a duopoly, it is very difficult to the smaller business to enter the industry and gain a market share. So they often collapse before they can become more competitive. Next, less competition means less strive for the business for to produce new products, while it has innovation and the vibrancy of the market. Next, the limited consumer choice. If consumers are unhappy,
yes, Ravindra,
then
take questions, yes, please. Take questions.
Yes, sir. Any questions? Yes.
What is the difference of monopoly and duopoly?
Monopoly and duopoly. A duopoly is a form of oligopoly and should not be confused with a monopoly, where only a single producer exists and controls the market. With a duopoly, each company will tend to compete against the other, keeping prices lower and benefiting the consumers.
Okay.
Thanks, Ravanya. Sorry to stop you as we are running out of time. I couldn't give you more time. Okay, that was, sir, a good one. All the best.
Thank you, sir.
So next is Pranati. Are you there, Pranati?
Yes, sir.
Go ahead, Pranati.
Good morning, sir, and good morning, everyone. Myself, Pranati, and my roll number is 27. And my topic is about oligopoly market. Oligopoly is when a small number of firms collide, either explicitly of facility to restrict output and fix prices in order to achieve above normal market returns. Economic, legal, and technological factors can contribute to the formation of maintenance and dissolution of oligopolies. The major difficulty that oligopolies face is the prisoner's dilemma that each member faces, which encourages a member to cheat. Government policy can discourage or encourage oligopoly behavior, and themes of mixed economic often see government blessings for ways to limit competition. Understanding oligopoly. Oligopolies in history include steel manufacture, oil companies, railroads, fire manufacturing, grocery store chains, and wireless carriers. Types of oligopoly market. Open oligopoly market. And next, closed oligopoly market, collusive oligopoly, competitive oligopoly, and partial oligopoly.
Okay, go with questions.
Pranati, what is the disadvantages of oligopoly?
High concentration rate.
You are not audible.
Okay. Have you heard about kinked demand curve? Kinked demand curve?
No, sir. I don't know. Sorry, sir.
Fine. Thank you.
Thank you.
Sorry, I was stopping others to question. Time is the limitation. Thank you.
Sorry, sir.
I think do well with your exams also. Carry all these imperfect markets to your exams also. Next, please.
Good morning, sir. Good morning, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, go ahead, Hemant.
Good morning, sir. Today's my topic is about...
nice beard here. Till yesterday, I had the beard.
Sir?
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, I am telling you about the topic. Oligopoly. It consists of a small number of buyers and small number of buyers dominated by the seller. Here, one example is about the Americans, like McDonald's. They have very few buyers and the seller, because not everyone cannot go to the McDonald's. So they have a price fixed by the buyers, and some characteristics of oligopoly is a small number of buyers, few alternatives, and barriers to entry. Here, the small number of larger buyers indicates that there are only few buyers, and the sellers are higher than the buyers. So that is about the small number of larger buyers. And a few alternatives means if one company get a product for the buyers, they have only a few alternatives to sell the product to the buyers, because of there are small number of buyers to buy the concerned product. And barriers to entry means if we keep one company in the concerned area, then the company's name and the patent rights and the government policies, such as they have to acquire the brand name and some patent rights in the concerned area. These are the barriers to entry and some of the behaviors of oligopoly. It is interdependence, rigid prices, and non-price competition, and mergers and pollution.
Maybe one question for you, Hemant. Can you give an example of oligopsony or monopsony or anyone in Indian context? Do you have?
Making up.
Go on. Right, you're right.
Don't know about India, but it's a
okay. fine That's a good try. Any other question?
Sir?
Yes,
sir.
Okay. Thank you, Hemant.
Thank you, sir.
Next. Kausalya will be talking about.
Hello, sir. My name is Kausalya. Today, I'm going to explain about monospony. Monospony is a market problem? Condition. Monospony. Monopsony is a market condition where there is a few sellers and a one buyer only. Here the buyer controls and manipulates the whole market and he purchases goods at large quantities. So it's called monopsonist. In monopsonist market, there is a price bargaining power and we can purchase goods at lesser value. So let's know the characteristics of the monospony. First characteristic, single buyer. So here the products are purchased as large quantity and only single buyer can purchase the goods. And resource ownership. Here the products are very specific. Every kind of products are not under into this market. So there are very limited resources and the products are very limited. Every product cannot enter into this market. So the monospony is all about job market. It is mainly concerned with the job market. So the starting of this concept is used in the book called The Economics of Imperfect Competition by John Robbins in 1933. And next statistics is no alternative buyer. There will be no alternative buyer in this market because here single buyer controls the whole market. And there are barriers to entry. There are many barriers to enter into the market. It's not very easy, like any other market. Okay, let's know about the barriers to enter into the market. Government license or franchise. Government won't provide any license to this kind of market because here the buying here buyer controls the whole market. Next one is resource ownership. As I have said earlier that. Here the products, every product can't be into the market and their resources are very limited. Patents and copyright. Patents and copyright are one of the barriers to enter into the market. Huge startup cost. So that in order to enter into the market, the cost is very higher. So for any normal people will think twice to enter into the market. So let's take an example of this market. So coal mine owner in the town. So I took an example of coal mine town. Here the coal mine owner is the buyer and the people in the town are sellers. Here the sellers are many, but the coal mine owner is a single one. He's the owner and he can influence the price because he's the only source of employment in the town. So he's the monopolist there. And government in the employment of civil servant, police and army office. Here the the buyer is government.
Oh, sorry, are you stoppable or unstoppable?
Unstoppable.
Yeah.
Any questions?
Faster. Pranthi, why are you so serious? Yeah, that looks good. Okay, there are no questions. They feel you're okay with them. Thank you very much. Next, Shruti will be talking about.
Good morning, 30. Sir. My name is Shruti. My roll number is 30. My topic is bilateral monopoly. Whereas bilateral monopoly exists when a market has only one supplier and one buyer. The one supplier will tend to act as monopolist and look to high price one buyer. In market capitalism, thrives the power of a single company to dictate waste decrease substantially. Bilateral monopoly market is characterized by one firm individually monopolist on the supply side and one firm individually. A monopolist on a demand side because a buyer and a seller of a product proposed do business with each other, they are clearly able to each legal binding agreement. Where it comes to the exception. That is a single commodity with a slow substitute. The monopolist needs a slow producer or seller. Monopolist is its only buyer. The monopolist and the monoponist are both free to maximize their own individual profit.
Hey, Shruti, you are looking like a newsreader here. You are so close up. Yeah, I suggest take the questions.
Any questions?
Can I ask a question? What is the difference between bilateral monopoly and monopoly?
What a monopoly refers to a single entity influencing a distorting a free market. In a monopoly, a single seller controls or dominates its supply of goods and services. That's it.
Okay. Thank you. Next time, you will not be news. Okay. Shruti.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Best of luck for the next time. Do well. All the good luck.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Monica will be talking now. Yeah, go ahead, Monica.
Good morning, sir. Myself, Monica. My topic is monopolistic competition market. Monopolistic competition market means is a form of imperfect competition. It can be found in many real worlds. Market ranging from customers of sandwich bars, other fast food shops, and coffee stores in busy town center to pizza delivery business in a city of headness is a local area. Monopolistic competition is similar to protect competition. Some economic regard it as more realistic because the products are differentiated. There are some assumptions in this market. There are many producers and many customers. The concentration is low. Consumers perceive that there are non-price differences among products. That is product differentiation. Competition is strong and plenty of customers switching takes place. Producers have some control price. There are price mates, not price takers. But price elasticity of demand is higher than it would be under a situation of monopoly. The barriers to enter and exit into of the market.
Monica, you are following Shruti in the footsteps of Shruti?
No, sir.
I suggest take the questions because we have your PPT with us. Okay? Yeah, take the questions.
Okay, friends, please feel free to ask questions.
Very good.
Can I?
Yeah.
The difference between perfect competition and monopolistic. I was not hearing.
Okay. Monica, thank you. I think I say the same what I said to Shruti. Okay. You try to keep or let the points be being very less, no problem at all. But when we are depending on something, you know, your intellectual abilities are getting diminished. That is the idea. Okay. All the best for the next time. I will see different Shruti and Monica. Okay. Yeah. Just a moment. Yeah. Harika will be talking now. Go ahead, Harika.
Good morning, sir. My topic is about prices in perfect competition market. A perfect market, a market situation in which a large number of producers are selling the homogeneous product which has the same physical characteristics. Pricing in perfect competition market. In perfect competition market, any profit maximizing market price equals to the marginal price. In perfect competition, the price of the product is determined at a point at which the demand and the supply curve intersect each other. In this market equilibrium, price of the product is determined. And the features of the perfect competition are a large number of sellers and buyers, homogeneous products, free entry and exit, mobility of factors and production,
price determination in perfect competition, price of the product is determined at a point at which the demand and supply curve intersect each other. Price determination can be analyzed in three different times: market period, short run, and long run. Market period is very short period in which the supply of the commodity is fixed, and short run, when price is less than the average total cost, the firm is making a loss in a perfect competition in the short run. And in the long run equilibrium of a perfectly competition market occurs when the marginal revenue equals the marginal cost.
Okay, I think it's good to see you, Harika, today. You have been interacting in the sessions, but I never saw you. It was
sir,
a
that
good
is not me, sir.
Time is up, dear.
Sir, that's not me,
if
sir.
You want,
another
you can take the questions. Sorry?
Roll number 13, there is another Harika, sir.
Oh, it's not you?
No, sir.
Oh, two Harikas are there?
Yes, sir.
Okay, okay, fine. Anyhow, anyone has questions for 32 Harika? Roll number 32 Harika.
Yes, sir. I have a question for her. Yeah. And can you please tell me the key features of a perfect market?
Free entry and exit, and that's it.
Okay, fine, fine, no problem. Thank you, Harika.
Yes,
all the best for your exams.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, so Navya is there.
Yes, sir.
Navya will be talking. I'm sorry.
Yes, sir.
Yes, go ahead.
Good morning, sir. Myself Navya, and today my topic is on pricing in imperfect market. When we come to the pricing term, pricing refers to the particular value which is given to a good or a service. Which is given to the good or a service. The pricing can be more when there is a high demand of the product or the service. When we come to this pricing methods, the way in which the product and the services can be, the way in which the product and services can be considered considered in the process of selling a good, like the factors and the expansion factors like expansion, product life, and the firm where the place where the firm is existing, etc. And the term when we come to the imperfect market, the imperfect market is an individual buyers and the sellers can influence the price and the production. There is no other influence of full disclosure of information, but the product and the price and their high barriers to entry, and they have a high barriers to entry and the exit in the market. And we have a types of imperfect market, monopoly, oligopoly, and duopoly, oligopoly firm, and bilateral monopoly. That's it, sir. Already my friend has explained about this all. So I can take questions now. Hello?
Questions? To Navya?
Hello? Hello? Navya?
Oh, yes, sir. Sorry.
Explain about the example of monopoly.
In this monopoly, we have a different types.
In Indian context.
Sir,
I want an example of monopoly.
We have an Indian context. We have a Indian railways where we have a high demand and we have only single seller and with high demand of consumers. This Indian railway is from my Indian context, and from US we have a different type of context also.
Okay. Thank you, Navya. That was a good one, confident one. All the best.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. So next is Madhusudan will be talking now. And give
delta Y by delta I. And also you have to know about significance of MPC, where income increases, the MPC falls more than APC, average propensity to consume. Where income falls, the MPC also rises, and APC also rises, but a slower rate than the former. And MPC and nature of country. MPC is higher in the case of poor people than in the rich. Why? Because in rich countries, all the satisfied needs are satisfied actually, and also increments also have to saved. Whereas in poor country, all the unsatisfied needs have been unsatisfied. So there is higher marginal propensity to consume. So this is the reason MPC is higher in the underdeveloped countries, Asia, Africa, lower in developed countries such as US and UK. And the final conclusion, marginal propensity to consume acts as an indicator and shown lot of character towards the consumption function, and also helps to quantify the relationship between income and consumption. That's it, sir. Thank you, sir.
Suri, what is the disposable income?
Income after taxes and transfers.
Okay. Suri, you gave me the reason for underdeveloped countries when compared to developed countries. Is that your own or is it of someone else view?
Yes, sir. It's in our own, sir. Actually, underdeveloped countries like Asia, Africa, is low in marginal propensity to consume. Why? Because basic needs have been unsatisfied. And also, increments have to be income consumption. So,
you take countries, not continents. In Asia, Japan, China are very rich, super rich. In Europe, there are many countries which are underdeveloped. In Africa, South Africa is rich, something like that. Good, very good. That is customized, that is personalized by Suri. I think anyone will appreciate this kind of presentations with personal views, personal philosophies. Very good. All the best.
Thank you.
So that was Suri. Then Hemalatha's presentation. Hemalatha, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Good morning to one and all present here. My name is Hemalatha and my topic is about investment function. Now I would like to introduce what is investment. Investment is an asset or item that is purchased with the hope that will generate income in the future. It is called as the investment. And I would like to introduce types of investment. Financial and real investment. Financial investment, it refers to the expenditure on the purchase of stocks and shares of the existing companies. Is called as the financial investment. And the real investment. Real investment is expenditure on the purchase of goods that increase in the enhancement of production to the domestic economy of the country. And I would like to induced and autonomous investment. Induced investment, according to the Professor Kaiser said that when the increase in the investment due to the current level of the increase in the current income is known as the induced investment. And the autonomous investment is about introduction of the new techniques and the products and the using of the new resources is known as the autonomous investment. And the private and the public investment. The private investment refers to the investment made by the private individuals is known as the private investment. And the public investment is the central provisionals and the state government to the sake of the people, to the welfare of the people is known as the real investment. And I would like to invest and I would like to tell about the gross investment and net investment. Gross investment, the total expenditure incurred on capital good at any given time in the economy is called as the gross investment. And net investment, that analyzes the economy stock of real capital assets, thereby adding productive capacity, is known as the net investment. And the voluntary and involuntary investment. Voluntary investment, when the entrepreneurs invest the amount according to the perfect plan and achieve some objective, is about the voluntary investment. And the involuntary investment, which is an involuntary which is an involuntary incurred by an investor, is called as an involuntary investment. And now I would like to tell about the what is the investment function. Investment function is a relationship between.
Yeah, go ahead. Okay, let me put question. As you have more stuff there to read out. Hemlata, investment is a function of what?
Investment is a function of relationship between the investment and interest rate, sir.
Investment is a function of interest rate or anything else?
Interest rate and investment, sir.
So how does income affect investments? There is no, there is there a relationship?
Yes, sir. There is a income affects how it, there is a income increase in the income that is affecting the, stimulates the investment, and the decrease fall in the investment, and it is affects the investment, and it is a fall in the income, and it damages the investment.
Okay, thank you, Hemlata. That's a good one for your presentation. Thanks. All the thank best. You. Naveen's topic on.
Hi sir, good morning. I am Naveen. I am telling about marginal efficiency of capital.
MEC.
The marginal efficiency of capital is introduced by Keynes in his own theory, and the marginal efficiency of the marginal efficiency of capital is equal to the rate of discount and the returns expected from the capital assets during its life, and the Keynes, generally a lower interest rate makes investment relatively more attractive, and the factors of which is just the marginal efficiency of capital is the cost of change and expectations and business confidence and supply of finance and demand for goods.
Go on, whatever.
Yeah, folks. The marginal efficiency of capital is compared to the rate of interest. And the finally, marginal efficiency of capital is curve as the stock of capital increase and the marginal efficiency of a capital is decrease. That's also.
Okay. One question to you.
Yes, sir.
Naveen.
Yes, sir.
When does marginal efficiency of capital decrease? When does MEC drop? When do you see fall in MEC? Okay. Thank you. Do well for the next time. That's all I can say. Okay.
Thanks.
Pratyusha's presentation. Go ahead, Pratyusha.
Good morning, sir. My topic is Tobin's Q. Tobin's Q theory was developed in 1968 by James Tobin. It is the ratio between market value and replacement value of the same physical asset. And the formula for Tobin's Q is market value by assets value. If the Q value is greater than 1, we can say the firm is earning a rate of return larger than the replacement cost of the firm. If it is less than 1, we can say the firm is undervalued. Disadvantages of using this Tobin's Q ratio is the exact replacement cost for all assets may not be available, and valuation of investments and valuation of intangible assets is not easy to value them. It cannot be used to base investment decisions with regards to purchase or sale of equity shares. And even though it is practically applicable, others have found that fundamentals predict investment results much better than the Q ratio, including the profit rate of profit or average rate of profit of company. And this Tobin's Q depends on the current and future expected benefits from installed capital. Investors with valuable information to guide their decisions. Whether the ratio is greater than 1 or less than 1, it determines the investment of a firm. Thank you, sir. Any questions?
Okay. No questions. Thank you very much, Pratyusha.
Thank you, sir.
It is short and sweet. I wish all of you will do the same way. Instead of reading the whole thing for several minutes, just give your opinion. That's it. That will do. Thank you, Pratyusha.
Thank you, sir.
Manoj. Go ahead, Manoj.
Good morning, sir. My name is Manoj and my roll number was 40. Today, my topic was functions of money. And firstly, what is money? Money is an object of, it was generally accepted by all payments for the goods and services and for the repayment of the debt. And next one is, what are the functions of money? And first one is the medium of exchange, and second one is the value of money, and third one is stored, it acts as a stored value, and fourth one is it acts as a credit, and fifth one is the standard of postponed payments. And first one, medium of exchange. The medium of exchange is an instrument of system used to facilitate the sales and purchases of the goods in between the parties. And next one, measure of the value. It serves as a common measure of value. The value of goods and services are expressed in terms. And next one, acts as a store value. Money is most liquid form of wealth. It can be stored without loss in value. Money enables people to save a part of his incomes and store for the future purpose. It is an act of store value. And next one is the basis of credit. It facilitates loans. Borrowers can use their money to obtain the goods and services. Banks create their credit on the basis of the bank reserves, cash reserves, sorry. And next one was standard of postponed payments. It means those payments which are made in the future. The loan is taken today and then the amount should be paid back after a period of time. It is the standard of postponed payment. That's it. Any question?
Okay, next.
Good morning, sir. My name is Punyavati. My roll number is 41. My topic is demand for money. Money is the medium of exchange in the form of coins and banknotes in the real world. However, money provides monetary services along with tangible renewable. Demand for money. The demand for money is the total amount of money that the population of an economy wants to hold. The three main reasons to hold money as opposed to bonds, equity, and other financial assets classes are as follows. Demands for money are classified into the four types. They are transaction motive, portfolio motive, speculative, and precautionary motive. Transaction demand for money. The money we need to purchase goods and goods in day-to-day life. And goods in day-to-day life. Portfolio motive.
Someone is distracting Punyavati. Who is that?
No, sir.
Manoj, is that you?
No, sir.
Go ahead, Punyavati. No. Okay. Will you take questions? Give some example of precautionary motive, Punyavati. Do you have?
No, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Next.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, okay.
So 44 and
then
45.
We'll go to Bhaskar. Bhaskar, are you there? Bhaskar. 42 Bhaskar. Not 64 Bhaskar. 64 Bhaskar will hit me. Sir, why are you calling me since morning? He said. Are you ready, Bhaskar? Go ahead, Bhaskar.
Yes, sir. Today,
Yeah. Good morning, sir, and good morning, my class. Today's topic is forms of money supply. And in my presence, I will take a particular positions like what in three categories of my presentation, like what is and why and how it's useful and how many types.
Simply, but keep what it shorter, is 2 minutes.
Yeah, sure, sir. Yeah, money supply is definitely for one of all money supply kept by the central bank of the country. The changes of supply in the economy affect the price level of securities like inflation and exchange business policies and etc. And the aggregate types of money supply, there are three types. One is full-bodied money, token money, and third one is representative full-bodied money. So which means full-bodied is the type of money whose value as money is equivalent to the value of commodity, like example, gold coins. And first one types of money that refers to next token money, like means full body. Wait a moment. It has a value of the money as much more than the commodity. Example, paper currency. And last one is representative full bodied money, a type of kind of money which is issued against the value of billion, like gold, silver in bulk with issuing the authority. And filing the money supply, which reverts something aggregate to concepts like types of deposits like current deposit, fixed deposit, and recurring deposit banks. That means M1 is equals to C1 plus DD plus OD, that is equals to narrow money, and M1, M2, where M2 is equals to M1 plus savings account, and M3 is equals to where M1 plus DD, that is broad money, and where M4 is equals to TD plus total deposit with post office. And finally goes to the money supply control. The money supply control is the economy which inflates the central bank of the country. The supply can be increased in economy by purchasing government securities such as treasury bills and government bonds. And that results happens with the central bank ties in with money and supply by selling securities on the open market and drawing liquidity funds out of the banking system. The purchase such as securities while supply is increased and interest rate rises. Mostly the money supply can control by the cash reserve ratio only. It is an essential monetary policy tool used for the controlling money in supply the economy. It regulation the implemented in the acts. Almost every nation by the central bank of the country. Thank you. Guys, any doubts?
I have a doubt, Bhaskar.
No, sir.
I used to ask you in the class, if I remember, I always used to prompt you, right? You remember? Okay. What is narrow money?
What is narrow money means? One minute, sir. Actually, I'm
one. Okay. What's the difference between base money and reserve money?
So wait a minute, sir. I'm just explaining about the narrow money means where M1 and M2 are known as narrow money, sir, and M3, M4 as the broad money. Okay. Where M1 is the most liquidity and easiest of transactions, where M4 is the
no,
least liquidity.
My question is there a difference between base money and reserve money?
Base money and reserve money, sir.
Yeah. Is there a difference?
Sir, can you repeat this again?
Is there a difference between base money and reserve money?
Base money and reserve money. No, sir. Actually, base
are
money is
the
way we can use. Sir.
My question is, are they the same or different?
Different, sir.
They are the same.
Same.
Thank you.
Stone is not worked, sir.
Yeah. Thank you. That's a good one.
Thank you, sir.
You need to fill more stuff into it, Bhaskar. Thank you. Yeah, next, because Chandraleka will be talking now. Go ahead, sir. Chandraleka.
Good afternoon, sir. I'm Teripia, and my roll number is 45. My presentation topic is narrow money and M1 and M2. So before saying about the narrow money, I'm going to say about money supply, because narrow money, M1 and M2 are the measures that I use to measure the money supply. So money supply is nothing but the total amount of money which is in circulation or which is present in the country's economy, and it can also be defined as the currency, like coins and the paper notes, or the demand deposits that are held by the public, which and also in the commercial banks, and it can also it consists of coins and deposits, which can be easily used as cash, and it is an easy transaction. And when coming to how the money supply is measured, there are many definitions regarding this, and there are four types of measures that are used to measure the money supply, and they are classified as M's. They are called as M1, M2, M3, and M4. The M1 can be simply said as C plus DD plus OD, whereas C is the currency held by the public, and the DD is the demand deposit that are held by the public in their banks, in the commercial banks, and the OD is the other deposits which are held in the RBI. And when coming to M2, it involves all the components or the items that I said above, like the currency held by the public and the demand deposits and the deposits plus the post office savings deposits of post office savings from the banks. This is called as M2. And when coming to the narrow money, it is the most narrowest money of all the measures that are used in the money supply. And it involves the physical currency, like small coins and the paper notes. And it is also the subset of the broad money. And when coming to the M1, it is the most basic form of medium of exchange that is happening in the country. And it can be as easily as convertible into the cash. That is called as M1. And the M2 includes all the cash that is held by the public and the demand deposits and the other deposits that are held by the RBI, and it also includes the post office savings which are saved in the saved by the public by the depositors. And the importance of narrow money is that it is important to know how much portion of money is broad and how much portion of the money is narrow, because the broad money cannot be easily accessible or easily converted into the cash. And I conclude that all these measures that are used to measure this money supply are important to know the policy formulation or to have an effective growth of money supply. That's all about my presentation. Thank you. Any questions?
Can you explain what are demand deposits?
Yeah, demand deposits are nothing but the current accounts and the saving accounts that are done by the depositors, and they can withdraw the cash anytime they need through checks and ATMs. That's all about demand deposits.
Okay, thank you, Chandralekha. That was a presentation with full of confidence and very professional, with a track of protocol kind of thing. There are no deviations. Very good. I appreciate that. Thank you.
Sir.
The next is Tejaswini. Yeah, go ahead, Tejaswini.
Good morning, sir. My topic is broad money. In money supply concept, they have four alternative measurements: M1, M2, M3, M4. M1, M2 is narrow money. M3, M4 is broad money. Definition of broad money: money in any form, including bank or other deposits, as well as notes and coins. M3 and M4 are broad money. M3 equal to M1 plus time deposits with the banking system. Example: personal deposits, corporate deposits, government deposits, organizational deposits. M3 is also broad money. M4 equal to M3 plus post office time deposits and term deposits. And components of broad money: currency with the public, demand deposits with the banking system, and other deposits with the RBI. Time liability portion of saving deposit with the banking system. That's it, sir.
Okay, done?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, any questions for Tejaswini?
Sir, can I ask a question?
Please.
How can the broad money is used?
Broad money is the most flexible method for measuring an economy money supply, accounting for cash and other assets easily converted into currency.
Okay. Thank you, Tejashwini.
Thank you,
sir. Next is Shravya.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Good afternoon, sir. My topic is about controls of money supply. The term money supply means is the total amount of money it is in available in cash or coins and notes, and it is in a form of circulation, and it is defined anything widely accepted as payment for goods and services. And controls of money supply, there are three instruments to control of money supply. First one is open market operation. Where open market operation refers to the selling and purchasing the treasury bills and government securities by central bank of any country. And second one is the discount rate. And open market has two types, expansionary open market and contractionary market operation. And discount rate, depending upon the context, discount rate has two different definitions and usages. First, discount rate refers to the interest rate charged to commercial bank and other financial institutions for loans. And and the second, the discount rate refers to discounted cash flow to determine the future cash flow. And third one, reserve requirements. The fraction of deposit the bank must hold reserve rather than loan out is called reserve ratio and is set by Federal Reserve. If, for example, reserve requirement is 1%, then the bank must hold reserve equal to 1% of their total customer deposits. Thank you. Any questions?
Shravya?
Yeah.
Examples for reserve requirements.
Okay. For reserve, consider, for example, taken a person X, he deposit 1 lakh in a bank. So that bank must hold 50% of his money, like the bank must hold 50,000. They didn't use that money to any other loans or investments. That's it.
What happens if money supply increased?
Okay, if money supply increases, lower interest rate and more investment, we get more investments and generate and top of money in customers' hands.
Okay, very good. Thank you. I missed that, Shravya. Next is Sindhuri. Go ahead, please.
Yes, sir. Good morning, sir, and my dear friends. My name is K. Gnanata Sindhuri, and I am going to present about open market operations. Open market operations refers to purchasing and selling of government securities and the treasury bills by RBI. The main objective of open market operations is to regulate the money supply. It is also refers to an activity by RBI to take or to give liquidity in its currency to a bank or a group of banks. The central bank can buy or sell government bonds in open market. Central bank gives a deposit for a determined period and takes an eligible asset as collateral. Key players, financial institutions, commercial banks, and RBI. RBI carries out open market operations through commercial banks and financial institutions and does not directly deal with the public. Aim of open market operations. The main aim of open market operations is, aside from supplying liquidity to commercial banks or taking excess from commercial banks to manipulate the short-term interest rate, to supply the base money in order to indirectly control the money supply, which efforts in expanding or contracting the money supply. OMO can be happening two ways. First one is short-term operations. Under short-term operations, first one is repo, which means repurchase agreement. In this, RBI buys securities from the commercial banks with an agreement to buy it back in predetermined period or a price. Next one is reverse repo. In this, RBI sells securities with an agreement to sell it back with predetermined purchase or a price. Next one is outright purchases, which is also known as FEMO. In this RBI carries out outright purchasing and selling of government securities. And finally, outcome of open market operations. With open market operations, interest rates will decrease and the fresh bonds will be issued at lower yield so that the government can purchase at reasonable rates and also enables corporates to buy at favorable rates. The main aim of open market operations is to regulate money supply. So with these, inflation may tend to increase. Thank you. Any questions, please?
Sindhu? Yeah. What is meant by outright purchase?
Outright purchase refers to purchasing or selling of securities without any agreement to buy it back or sell it back.
Sindhuri, okay. Is there any involvement of public in that?
No. RBI deals with only financial institutions and commercial banks. It indirectly deals with the public.
Very good, Sindhuri. That shows the level of presentation and efforts you have put. Very good.
Thank
nice
you,
to see you answering the questions directly. Very good. All the best.
Thank you.
Then,
sir, just a moment.
Yeah.
Hello, this is Arsha, sir. Sindhuri is not feeling well. If she's okay, then if it's okay, then she can leave, I think.
Yeah, that's fine.
No, sir, I'll continue.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Good. Bhavani, go ahead.
Good afternoon, sir. This is Bhavani and my roll number is 49 and my topic is multiplier. In microeconomics, a multiplier is a factor of proportionality that is measured how much an endogenous variable exchange to response to change of some exogenous variables. And some four types of multiples are complex multiples, local multiples, multiplier uncertainty, social multiple effects. And let us come to the complex multiple. The complex multiplier is a principle that can be formulated by John Maynard Keynes, and it can be calculated by using K is equals to 1 by MPS plus MRT plus MPM, where MPS is equals to marginal proportionality to save and MRT is marginal rate of taxation, MPM is marginal proportionality to input. And whereas local multiple effort, it is sometimes called as a local premium, and it is additional economical benefit accrued to an area of money being spent in a local economy. And whereas a multiple certainty in microeconomics, multiple uncertainty is a lack of perfect knowledge of a multiplier. Effects of a particular policy action such as a monetary or physio policy changes. And whereas the social multiple effort is a term used in the economics and economic geography and social and physical health. And it can be measured as the ratio of delta P by delta I, where delta I is an average response of an individual action. And delta P is the responsibility for a group of change in some parameters that affects the entire per group. Thank you, sir. Any doubts?
Okay. Thank you, Bhavani. Next is Anjali. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon, sir. My name is Anjali. So my topic is the term accelerator, sir. So the meaning of accelerator and multiplier, there are parallel concepts, sir. While multiplier shows the effects of changing investments on the changes in income, and while the coming to the accelerator shows the effects of change in consumption of private investment. So since the production of any given amount of final output usually requires an amount of capital several times, so the idea underlying the accelerator is of a functional relationship between the demand for consumption goods and the demand for machines which make them. So the formula for accelerator is denoted by beta equal to delta V by delta I by delta C, where delta I denotes the net changes in investments and delta C denotes the change in consumption, where V is stands for the coefficients of acceleration. So in actual words, however, increase your expenditure on consumption goods always leads to increased expenditures on capital goods. And while coming to the principle of acceleration is basically a concept related to the net investments. Therefore, we must drive an expression linking the acceleration with net investment. So gross investment equal to IGT equal to VYT. Sir, I don't know the gross investment. I forgot, sir. So then.
That's okay.
I'm getting shivers. Acceleration depends upon the primarily two factors. One is the capital output ratio, and another one is the durability of the capital equipment. So the final conclusion is that the theory of acceleration is based upon the idea that income and the stock of capital goods increase in flexible proportion. So we didn't do nothing only on accelerator. So when accelerator multiplied both hands, we can get upward and downward direction, sir. Thank you, sir. Can anyone ask questions?
Malini? Why multiplier is important for accelerator?
Why is?
Why it is important for accelerator?
Why is important of accelerator? It means
what is the importance of accelerator?
Yeah, importance of accelerator.
Okay, fine.
Ado.
Thank you, Anjali.
Thanks.
So next is Vinod Kumar, followed by Bhuvaneshwari and Amrita.
Yeah, okay, sir.
Yeah. Go ahead, Vinod.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon, sir. My name is Vinod Kumar, and my topic name is aggregate supply, sir. First of all, what is meant by aggregate supply means? Aggregate supply is defined as total amount of goods and services produced and supplied of an economy by firms over a specific period of time at a given price level, sir. And aggregate supply curve, sir. The aggregate supply curve shows the amount of goods that can be produced at a different price levels. And aggregate supply curve becomes inelastic when economy reaches a full of capacity, sir. That means when economy reaches its full of capacity, that means full employment when economy is on production possibility frontier. That means then the aggregate supply curve becomes inelastic even at a higher prices, sir. Firms cannot produce more even the short term. And next, the short-term aggregate supply. Short-term aggregate supply is the total supply of goods and services currently being achieved in an economy, and
give your point instead of reading out the whole thing.
Yeah, okay, sir.
We have your PPT with us. I think most of you, I'm telling you that, you give your view on that or give us points.
Yes, sir. Sure, sir. And in short-term aggregate supply is...
Okay, what's your topic, Vinod?
Aggregate supply, sir.
Sorry?
Aggregate supply, sir.
What do you mean? What exactly you mean by aggregate supply? What is aggregate supply in India? You mean by that?
Aggregate supply means it deals with production, capital and labor. It deals with that, sir.
Okay, fine. Your confidence levels are good, but you need to be practical on this, Vinod. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Just go back to the concepts and try to apply them so that you'll be much stronger. Okay?
Okay, sir. Okay.
All the best. Thank you.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. So Bhuvaneshwari, followed by Amrita and Revati.
Good morning, sir. This is Bhuvaneshwari. My roll number is 53. And my topic is national income, GDP, and GNP. Now, first, I am going to tell about national income, sir. It is aggregate monetary value of all goods and services produced in the country during a financial year. Increase in national income means that economy was grown. National income equals to national product. The production of $1 of goods or services creates a $1 of income. A per capita income stands at $200 in the fiscal year 2022-21 against the previous fiscal per capita income was $2,064. So the growth rate is 9%. While coming to gross domestic product, it will mean that the total value of goods produced and services rendered within a country during a year is a gross. We can calculate that P into Q. It means P is the price of goods and services and Q is the quantity of goods and services. It's calculated at market price and is defined as direct market prices. Different constituents of GDP, salaries, rent, and undistributed profit, etc. The full year for the year 2020 and 2021, this GDP is expected to be 34.4 lakh crore rupees against 1.5.7 lakh crore rupees in 2019 to 2000. And now I'm coming to GNP. GNP means gross national product. The market value of final goods and services produced in a year by the residents of the country within the domestic territory as well as abroad. And GNP is calculated as GDP plus NFI. GDP is a gross domestic product plus NFI is a net factor income from abroad. And in
Bhuvaneshwari, sorry to stop you. Your topic scope is much broader. Let me give you a question. What is the latest GDP of India for the financial year 2021? In dollars or rupees, it's up to you.
Dollars. Sir, can you repeat your question again?
What is the GDP of India?
For 2022-21, sir, 134.4 lakh crore rupees, sir.
Okay, I missed that. That's the reason I was asking you. So anyone else has any other question to Bhuvaneshwari? Okay, then thank you, Bhuvaneshwari. That was a presentation with good numbers. I appreciate you added the latest numbers. That is what every one of us have to do, but we have done it, Bhuvaneshwari. Thank you very much. All the best.
Thank you.
Then, next, Amrita, followed by Revati and Sri Harsha.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon, sir. My name is Amrita and my topic is inflation. First introduction, inflation is commonly understood as a situation of substantial in general increase in the level of prices of commodities, where prices of commodity increases and the value of money decreases. So firstly, I want to tell the consequences of inflation. Consequences of inflation are negative effects of inflation includes uncertainty over a future inflation, which may discourage investments and savings, and shortage of goods. So now I will tell the measures of inflation. Measures of inflation includes fiscal policy and monetary policy, where fiscal policy means inflation relates to the government policy with respect to the receipts and expenditure. Increase in direct tax, decrease in indirect tax, and surplus budget, and monetary measures like credit control and demonetization of money, and include a new currency, and other measures like increase in productivity and price control. So I wanted to conclude that inflation affects the consumer equilibrium. Thank you, sir. Any questions?
You directly say that. Okay. Thank you, Amrita, once again. Next, Shruti. followed by Sriharsha and Lipita. Yeah.
Good afternoon, sir. My topic is deflation. Deflation is a decrease in the general price of goods and services. The inflation rate will be decrease it to zero. When it is decreased to zero, there will be a loss of goods and services. When it leads to lose jobs for many people. The causes of deflation are monetary policy, fall in demand, and implementation and technology. Monetary policy is caused because of the central banks, because they decrease the amount. So when the amount is decreased, the supply of the production will be decreased. When the supply of the production will be decreased, the production would be decreased. Next, fall in demand for the overall demand. Yes, sir. The overall demand in the economy may be fallen down.
Okay, fine. Okay, let me stop you with a question. What do you mean by disinflation? I think one of your friends was asking in the class. Disinflation.
The decrease in the goods and services would be decreasing, sir, in the deflation.
Okay, thank you. Yes, thank you very much, Revati. As we are, I'm sorry, now I'm in a little hurry as we all crossed 12:30. Okay, thank you. Next is Sriharsha, followed by Likhita and Vaishnavi. Faster, please.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon, sir, and good afternoon, class. And today's my topic is per capita income. So the per capita income is basically the measure of the amount of earned by a person and in a nation or in a geographical area. This is calculated by the Central Statistical Organization, which is called a CSO, which is under the Ministry of Statistical and Program Implementation Department. And the basic calculation of per capita income is it is calculated by dividing the country's nation income and by its population. So the limitations are living standards, and I want to explain why it is calculated. To know the affordability of the particular region or a particular country or a particular state or a particular area, it enhances people to measure their affordability to live in this area, to invest or to do business in those areas. And the limitations are the living standards. If the living standards are high, then it may vary. And children under this, their children does not have any income. So per capita income does not include children. And international commitment or compromises, which comes under according to some international transactions or international compromises, this can also be affected. And to my topic, the per capita income of India in 2019 and 20 academically estimated as 1,35,000 rupees, and it is in a race of 6.8% to compare to 18 and 19. And according to 22nd May 2021, AP stands in 18th place with 1,68,480 national income. And in AP, districts like Krishna and Vishakhapatnam stand in first and second, with Krishna 1,89,101 rupees per capita income, and Vishakhapatnam with 1,78,166. And the last, the least affordable cities in Andhra Pradesh, when you see it as a statistics, it comes with Srikakulam, Vijayanagaram, and Srikakulam are the last. Anandapur are the last three cities which comes in least affordable areas in the country. And according to per capita income also, it states that Visakhapatnam stands in the 10th place of the richest cities in India. Thank you, sir.
Oh, that's good to know. That's damn good information you gathered. Proud to know that Visakhapatnam is among top 10 cities in India in terms of per capita income. That's a good one. Thank you very much, Harsha.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Any questions? Anyone want to ask any questions?
Okay. Thank you, Harsha.
Thank you, sir.
Next is Likita, followed by Vaishnavi and Yoshita. Go ahead.
Sir, good morning, sir. Myself, Likita. My topic is on repo rates. Repo rates in simple words. Yeah. Repo rates, which
is repo rate at your breakfast.
Sir, repo rates. Yes, sir.
Okay. Go on.
Repo rates in which the commercial banks borrowing from the RBI by using the government securities like some bonds or any sureties to achieve their fishing goals. And in case of the repo rates, dealers sell government securities in investors usually on an overnight basis or on the day, and buyers them back following the day at the slightly higher price. And the repo rates are usually uses some repo rates on sellers of the market have been sureties and intermediates. If the repo rate is increases, decrease the market economy, as well as the if the repo rate is decreases in the market, the repo economy is increases in the market. And due to the pandemic, the repo rate will be decreases through the some last 2 years. The repo rate meant sir. And supply in the markets, the interest rates bank have come down, and the people country started taking loans, and economic activity has been rebounded in this pandemic. This is the short note about the repo rate, sir. If any questions, please ask.
Likita, what is the repo rate in this year?
In 2019, the repo rate is in 4.40%.
Due to the pandemic, COVID. 2021, what is the repo rate?
Sir, 4%, sir. In last year, they decreased the rate because of the COVID, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Likita. So your voice, though your voice is low, it appeared to be your confidence was low. You have inner confidence. You did it so well. Thank you. All the best.
Sir, thank you, sir. Thank you.
Next is Vaishnavi, followed by Yoshita and Dhanalakshmi. Yeah.
Good afternoon, sir. Myself Vaishnavi. My topic is capital formation. Capital formation is the term to use to describe the net capital accumulation during on the accounting period of a capital goods and equipment, tools, transportation. There are two types of capital formation: gross fixed capital formation and the inventories. Gross fixed capital is called as investment, and it is defined as the acquisition of produced assets. And inventories are the kept in stock to ensure continuous production, like raw materials and finished goods. Thank you, sir. That's it. Any questions?
Sir, I would like to ask one question, sir.
Please.
What is the example of gross fixed capital?
Buildings, transportations.
roads.
Okay.
Okay. I wish Yoshita got answered. Thank you. Thank you, Vaishnavi, for your short and sweet presentation. Very good. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. So happy, right, with your present once the presentation is done. Good. But I wish learning should also be there, okay, along with your presentation. Good. So now Yoshita, followed by Dhanalakshmi and Manisha. Go ahead, please.
Good morning, sir. My topic is about foreign trade, sir. It is about trade between two or more nations is called as international trade, sir. And sorry, sir. And such a trade is also called as international trade, sir. And foreign trade transactions consists of three types, sir: import, export, and net export, sir. Import means if the seller is in abroad and the buyer is in home country. Export means when the seller is in the home country and the purchase is in abroad. And it also consists of a net exports, which means value of exports minus value of imports, sir. And is further divided into visible, invisible, and the capital transfer, sir. And the features of the foreign trade are imposition of restrictions in import and
go ahead. What happened? Technical problem or you stop?
You are stuck, Yoshita. Can you please check?
Yoshita, are you okay?
What? Yeah, now it's okay. You can go.
Hello?
Yeah, now it's okay. Yeah. Now it's okay. You can.
Now it's audible?
Yeah. Please, go ahead.
Features of the India's foreign trade are imposition of restrictions and import and export of various countries, and also restrictions on release of foreign currencies. And so states takes the control over the foreign trade, and it consists of the balance of trade, and it also consists of the balance of payment. Balance of trade, which means is also known as trade balance, refers to the differences between the monetary value of a country imports and when a country exports commodities, it gains foreign exchange. The balance of trade is also called can be favorable when the value of the exports exceeds, and it will be unfavorable when the imports exceeds exports. And next, factors that are affecting BOT, which means the cost of production is the exporting economy, those in the importing economy. Non-tariff barriers such as environmental, health, or safety standards. And then next, balance of payment. Balance of payment is a systematic record of all the economic transactions. It means, in a short way, accounts summarize international transactions for a period, usually a year, and are prepared in a single currency for the country concerned.
Okay.
Balance of payment consists of two types: current account and capital account. Capital account means the capital which transfers related to the purchase and sale of fixed assets such as real assets. Thank you, sir. Is there any questions to be asked?
Yoshita, explain about the surplus and deficit.
Sir. Hello?
Yeah, go ahead.
Hello. Sir, if the debates exceed the credits, then a country is running a trade deficit. If the credit exceeds the debits, the country is running a trade surplus. Hope you got the answer.
Okay. Thank you, Yoshita. That was a good one. It was so narrative, you know. It was so good. If time was there, we would have allowed you, given you more time. But time was not permitted. Thank you very much.
All the best. Thank you, sir.
So next is Dhanalakshmi, followed by Manisha and Kranti Kumar.
Yes, sir. Good morning, sir.
Morning.
My topic is repo rates and market. Then what is repo rate? The rate at which the central bank of country RBI lends money to commercial banks. Sir,
yeah, go ahead.
The rate at which the central bank of country RBI lends money to the commercial banks in the event of any shortfall of funds and reverse repo rate, where the RBI borrows money from the banks when there is excess liquidity in the market during high level of inflation in the economy, the RBI increases the reverse repo rate. How affects repo rate? It affects us primary lending rate, and the primary lending rate affects us interest rate. Commercial banks change their customers. Advantage of repo rate: increase in turnover in the money market. Repos increase the volume in debit market. Central banks can use repo as integral part of their open market operations. And advantage of reverse repo rate: deposit of money becomes risk-free, and increase the reverse repo rate means that RBI will borrow money from the banks at high rate of interest. We can conclude.
Yoshita and Dhanalakshmi, please stay back. Yoshita and Dhanalakshmi, please stay back. I can't see you.
Yes, sir.
Yoshita, Dhanalakshmi.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, please take back. Turn on your videos.
Sir, my video online only.
Yoshita and Vaishnavi, sorry. Yoshita and Vaishnavi, please turn your videos on.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, go ahead, Dhanalakshmi. Sorry,
then we continue. Okay, sir.
Yeah,
then we conclude the repo rate significance, the rate which liquidity is injected in the banking system by RBI. When reverse repo rate signifies the rate at which the central bank absorbs the liquidity from the banks. That's it, sir. Any questions?
Can I ask, sir?
Yeah.
What is the latest repo rate of India?
In India? Hold on. 6.4% something.
Okay, Dhanalakshmi, repo rate, reverse repo rate. Usually, which one is higher?
Repo rate.
Okay, thank you. That was a good try. So Krantikiran was distracting you. You did it well. Okay, give him a punch after the session. Okay, thank you. Next is Manisha, followed by Kranti Kumar and Sirisha. Go ahead.
Good morning, good afternoon, everyone. So my topic is foreign exchange rate. Foreign exchange rate, which is also known as Forex, is the conversion of currency of one country to another country. So the major participants in these exchange rates are government, central banks, central banks, RBI, residents, non-residents, etc. There are basically three types of foreign exchange market. First one is fixed and floating exchange market rate. Second one is direct and indirect. And the last one is spot and forward exchange rate. So the fixed rate is basically fixed by the monetary authority, like government, banks, etc. The next one is floating exchange rate, which is fixed, which is set up by the forex exchange market itself based on the supply and demand of the currency. The second one is direct and indirect exchange rate. Direct exchange rate, it quote the currency of which explains foreign currency in terms of domestic currency. Like if we have to explain $1 in Indian currency, in our domestic currency, it is now 72.62. Now the indirect currency, it is exactly opposite to the direct currency. It is the domestic currency explained in terms of foreign currency. The last one is spot and forward. Spot is the exchange rate which we exchange immediately. And the forward is the exchange rate which we see after 1 year in future. Like Chinese wants to sell something to US. After 1 year, they will see the exchange rate after 1 year, whether it is increasing or decreasing. Now I'll deal with the factors which influence exchange rate. They are inflation rate, interest rate, and economic policy and monetary policy and tourism. That's it. If anyone wants to ask questions. Any questions?
You said inflation influences foreign exchange rate, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Say, for example, today Indian rupee versus dollar is 70 rupees. Okay. 70. Now, inflation from previous period to this period, it has gone up from 5% to, say, 10%. A blunt example, it has increased by 5% to 10%. Then what will happen to the exchange rate?
It will increase. As because the value of our currency is going down, sir.
Good. Thank you. Very good. So that's about Manisha. She has come and she has given and she has answered questions straight away. Next is Kranti Kumar. Go ahead.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Kranti Kumar.
Turn your video on, man.
And my topic is foreign direct investment.
Turn your video on.
By coming to the foreign direct investment, it is a process of a residential one country acquiring the ownership of another country. Like that, in the basis of production, profit, and etc. And there are some other theories which is describes about foreign direct investments. I want to say about two theories. One is industrial organization theory. The theory which describes about the MNCs companies with this higher technology, they want to publish their innovative products in the companies in another countries. By coming with their innovative products, they can publish more products in that. And coming to the another theory, location specific theory, like that they set a location in the basics of they'll giving specific amount like more about raw materials and cheap labors. In this theory, they are mainly focused on raw materials and cheap labors, because when there is cheap labors, they can profit more. And coming to that, there are some types of FDS like that. There are the types is that first one, target by motive and by direction and by the entry modes. By coming to the targets, there are two targets like horizontal FDA and vertical FDI. By coming to the horizontal FDI, they mainly focus, they divided into like they set the another company with the equal to the first company, like home company. For example, if you take one mobile, if take a MI mobile store, they build MI mobiles, and another company is also used to build same mobile like MI mobile products only. By coming to the vertical, here vertical is differ from horizontal because here horizontal the products are made equal to in both countries, but in vertical the product is made by stage. Like if the one country is made raw materials like batteries, processors and that all, and another country is make a built in like mobiles by example display and the external outview. And by coming to the by motive, they use it to they set a motive to launch their company in another country with they seeing for resources, marketing and references. And by coming to the by directions they are two directions, inward and outwards. Inward states that the company will produce invest on the local companies. By that they can boost up their local companies. By going to the outward FDI, here the company which deals about is a business strategies, like business strategies like the domestic company uses to set in the foreign countries, like that they can acquire more profit and they can survive. And by coming to the entry modes, there are two entry modes. First one is a greenfield and second one is merge. First one, by coming to the greenfield, they use it to focus on the green farms and forest. And merge is that the two companies will combine together and set another company to another foreign. By that they can shares get Rajiv shares and profits.
Rajiv Kumar, conclude that you are just reading out. You are hungry.
Sir, actually I am not reading, I am explaining, sir. Okay, sir, I want to conclude.
Oh, wow, that's great, then continue. We are not happy.
Sorry, sir. I am concluding, sir.
Okay.
I want to conclude by saying two routes.
If you are not reading out and talking to yourself, please continue. We are not hungry.
No, sir. we can enter in Indian FDI in two ways. Like the automatic route and the government route. The automatic route state that we can invest or publish our company in another country without any government or RBI approval. And by coming to the government route, we have to take approval from government. Like that, there are some companies like software companies are mainly come from government route only. Thank you, sir. Is there are any questions to ask me?
Bhaskar and Sirisha, what are your expressions? You didn't understand or you don't have any question? Just ask them, Kranti Kumar.
Sir, about the topic.
Are they shocked with your presentation? Shocked by your presentation. Dhanalakshmi is not seen. Dhanalakshmi, Manisha, what's your opinion on Kranti Kumar's presentation?
It was good, sir.
Good. Yeah. Okay. I think it was so self-explanatory presentation. Okay. With clarification. Thank you. I thought you were reading that because it was not. So, yeah, where is Kranti Kumar? Kranti Kumar.
Sir.
Why are you shying away here?
Not at all, sir. Locked like that.
Till I finish today, you be there. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Don't vanish.
Ah, okay, sir. I will then.
Yeah. Kranti Kumar is done. Now we have Sirisha followed by Bhaskar and Harika. Harika, can you give now? Manisha, you also sir, stay back, please. Put your mic on. Hey, Harika, yes, you are ready now.
That and Venkat also ready, sir. 21.
21. He finished, no?
I think you said...
good, yeah. Usually towards the end, students get discharged. Now you're charging up. Good, good. Yeah, Sirisha, you can start. All of you, please sir, be attentive and interact with your friend. Yeah.
Sir, my name is M. Sirisha. My role number is 63. Today topic is foreign exchange markets. The meaning of foreign exchange market is foreign exchange market, also known as Forex, by which one currency is exchanging to another. Forex is an international market for the trade of currencies. Trades place orders to buy one currency to another currency. Importance of foreign it is very important because exchange rate, the price of one currency in terms of another, helps to determine the nation's economy health and hence the well-being of all people residing in it. It is the world's largest market, still growing quickly. Trade can be profit for both strong and weak economics. Trades can place very short term orders, which are prohibited in the same of the market. And futures of the forex markets are market is according to the banks of international settlements. The preliminary global results for the 2016 Central Bank Survey of the Foreign Exchange and OTC Derivatives Markets Activities show the exchange rate markets average 5.1 per day in April 2016. Forex market exchange, the types of forex market exchange markets are spot market, forward market, future market, swap market, options market. Types of exchange rates in forex market: fixed exchange rate, floating exchange rate, direct exchange rate, indirect exchange rate, spot exchange rate. In a forex market in India, participants in foreign forex exchange markets are central banks, commercial banks, traditional banks, traders and brokers also.
Calm down, cool down, have some water if you want.
Foreign exchange markets in India. The origin of the foreign exchange market in India could be traced to the year of 1978, when the banks in India were permitted to undertake intraday trades in exchange, trades in foreign exchange. However, it was in the 1990s that the Indian foreign exchange market for reaching the exchange along with the shifts in the currency in India, globally, options in a foreign exchange market started in the major way after the breakdown at the Bretton Woods system in 1971. Over the year, foreign exchange market has emerged as the large market in the world. The decade of 1990s, decade of 1990s, perceptible policy shifted.
Look at the camera.
Shifted many emerging markets towards the reorientation of their financial markets in the terms of new products instruments in the terms of new products and instrument in this foreign exchange market is risk also there. Any sale or purchase of foreign currency entail foreign exchange rate risk for foreign exchange transitions. Foreign exchange transition affects the net assets position of the buyers and sellers carrying the net assets or net liability positions in the foreign currency gives risk to exchange that's it, sir. Sir? Hello, sir? Hello?
Question.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, any questions? Any questions to Sirisha? She burned sir. All her calories for the presentation today. She lost many calories. Okay, she got exhausted. She gave everything today. Okay, any question to Sirisha? On Forex market? Okay, thank you, Sirisha. I think yours probably was the longest presentation today. It's up to 4 minutes or more than that. Thank you. Do well for your exams also. All the best.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Yeah. So next is Bhaskar, followed by Harika and Venkat. And others remain there. Stay there. Yeah. Go ahead. Bhaskar.
Good afternoon.
Yeah. That guy is in nice direction. Very good background and charged. Good. Go ahead.
Good afternoon, sir. Myself, Bhaskar. My topic is foreign portfolio investments. When coming to foreign portfolio investments, it is the entry of funds into a country where foreigners deposit money in country's bank or make purchases in terms of stocks or bonds. And any individual or companies or foreign governments can invest their monies in the foreign portfolio investments. And by using foreign portfolio investments, we can have quicker returns on investment. And also by following some steps and methods, we can have more profits. But the disadvantage is we have no direct control. And if there is any changes of laws by the other foreign companies, government, we may have the lesser profits or we may also lose the investments. Generally, foreign portfolio investment consists of securities and alternative foreign financial assets that are passively held by a foreign investor. Foreign portfolio investor can access equities, bonds, derivatives, mutual funds, and also stocks. That's it, sir. Any questions?
Yeah, Bhaskar, can you give an example of a foreign portfolio investment, FPI?
Examples are like investing in Bitcoin and investing in Dogecoins are also the examples of investing in foreign portfolio.
What is the size of FPIs in India as in today or last week or last month? Any idea?
No idea.
Okay, no problem. Check those things. It's very interesting, FPIs, because SEBI or through RBI, you get the data. FPI weekly data is there. You can check FPIs increasing means markets are booming. FPIs are coming means markets are following. There is some correlation. There are some research works also done. Get that information. Okay. Okay. So just stay back. We have two more. Yeah. Harika. Ready? Harika is one among which always fights with me. Am I audible to you, Harika? No, why she is tensed? Okay, go ahead. Still a connectivity problem?
Please unmute yourself. Or unmute you can... yourself. Harika.
Turn your mic on, Harika. I believe she still got some technical problem. Okay, we'll come back to you. Venkat, can you do it?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. My topic is a production function and types. The production function shows the relationship between the inputs and outputs of a organization. Inputs means the raw materials we purchase, and outputs means final goods we sell in the market. The functions are Leontief production function, Sess production function, and Cobb-Douglas production function. And the factors of production functions are land, labor, capital, and investments. And we can decrease the production functions by implementing technology in the organization and decreasing the advertising cost. And we can decreasing the cost of raw materials. It means we purchase the raw materials in our state only. We cannot. We use the resources in our state, we can decrease the production cost. We cannot import from other states and other countries for raw materials. That's all, sir. Thank you. Any questions?
Any idea about Cobb-Douglas production function? You have any idea, Venkat?
Sir, a little bit. It was introduced by American economist. It shows that we can cut off the supplies to their limits. For example, capital and labor is the limit we can replace to the other products, other functions. Am I right, sir, or any wrong?
Fine. That's a good try. Instantly, you have responded. That is the thing which I'm looking at. I'm not testing your accuracy or correctness here. Okay, that will be tested in your examination. Okay, so I'm just saying to what extent you have the ownership of your own topic, to what extent you're confident on giving your topic. From here onwards, you can make it empirical and get it tested in your examination also. Okay.
Yeah, okay.
I think we are done. Veena and Harsha, what you can do is immediately once I log out of this session, those who couldn't give me the presentation today, maybe some technical problems or something, or an MS Teams problem in their mobile or something like that, they can give me a WhatsApp call, a video call, and finish the presentation. Please message them. Okay? So I think as of now, Venkat's was the last presentation. Am I right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Fine.
Yes, sir.
So, yes. I wish to thank you all for your wonderful presentation. The first semester itself, you have followed my guidelines. You've given your best, I can see that. You met my objectives and I met my objectives. So the class met the objectives, where the objective is to make or groom the student to present his or her own topic to a broad platform with full confidence, so that learning becomes bigger and bigger. Okay, so can you share, was this platform or presentation methodology useful to you? Anyone can respond.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Was this useful to you?
Yes,
because
sir.
There were a lot of words put by me, put by you, put by class representatives, Harsha and Veena, beyond the screen. Everyone was putting their own efforts. So my question to you is, these efforts were fruitful? They are helpful to you?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
May I hear one by one, what was your experience, what was your learning, and how it is useful? Yeah, your feedback will let me do it better for your next semesters or for your juniors. That's the idea. When you say what is good, what is bad, you know, we can plug into the holes which are not required, and we can leverage more on the good things. That is the idea. You can, you feel free, please. You share whatever you want.
Sir,
it's very useful to us, sir.
Yeah, this, from my end, most of the friends are not able to, and dare to give their presentations or any seminars, like anything in front of all people. But by this option, they are reducing their, scare regarding about this. And they're trying to give the presentations as much as they can.
Very good. Thank you.
Hello, sir. Sir, actually, I was least interested in exchange rates, foreign exchange rates. I know nothing about this thing. And because of my not interested in those topics, sir.
So the topic made you confident and stronger.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, if someone asks you about foreign exchange rate, you will just blast them, right?
Yes, sir. I can. Yes, sir. I gain
the
quite confidence.
Yeah, good. Good to know that.
Yes, sir. Can I?
Yeah, please. Anyone.
I thank you for keeping the guidelines very, what I can say is that these are very good guidelines, sir. This is the first session from last. This is the fourth session that we have been doing these mini reports. But none of these sessions has completed. It took time, but four hours 40 minutes our session has been gone, and 50 odd above members are still participating in the session, and that's the great issue. And I have already texted in our group that the patience levels are very high, and thank you, sir. Thank you for your continuous guidance and your instructions. I definitely thank you for that. And today's topic, regarding my topic, my topic was very big and very huge. I know, according to my roll number, I know that after a certain time period, after 50 roll numbers, faculty will say, yeah, time is up. You can start it. You can make it quick and finish it off. But I just given my presentation, I think so, as far as I can in that short 1 minute or 1.5 minute time. So thank you, sir. I think I have done it quite good. I think so. Thank you so
much. My pleasure, Harsha. My pleasure.
21, Venkat.
Yeah. Venkat, go on.
It is very useful, sir.
after a long time, I am seeing all my classmates' faces. I'm getting a classroom.
It's your atmosphere. Class. At least me too. Me too. I've seen my class today after a long time. Yeah.
Yes, sir. I'm very joyful to see these faces. That's it.
Good, good. Yeah, when peer effect is there, you automatically you get connected with the subject and topic. That effect is also there, which is not measured, which is not seen, which is qualitative. Yeah.
Sir, according to my experience today, it is a great platform for the students like us to we will learn how to face the crowd through our presentations, and also questions, how to answer the questions. And above all that, I would really appreciate the patience of you, sir, because it's almost 4 hours. From morning onwards, you have been listening to all our presentations. It's really great, great, sir.
I love it, yeah. That's
okay, sir. That's it.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Sir, we have learned so many things, sir, about how to do a presentation and how to give a presentation. And also we had learned that the topic that given to me was foreign portfolio investment. Before this presentation, I had only small knowledge on this topic. But after this presentation, I had gained so much knowledge over this topic. It may be useful in the future also, sir.
Good. Thank you.
And thank you for your guidelines.
My pleasure, yeah. Welcome.
Before the concept was given FDI, I don't know about the concept, and I got into fear, sir. And in that time, Vicky used to help me how to present it, and he given topic and material to describe and teach, sir. By that, I can learn this topic very much. Now I can appreciately, I can present my topic with very easily, and. And not only for from ourselves, sir, you also given a best time for us, and given the topics and divided the concept. You given us more time to you building our confidence and being back end. Giving time to and encourage while we are presenting, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much for your feedback, Kranti Kumar. So that sufficed my job. Mission accomplished, I could say that, right? So you believed me, you trusted me. I was asking you with me, without me, with me, without me yesterday. I think you guys are with me, and you elevated yourself and you made me proud. Thank you one and all for your participation, and all the very best for your end-term examinations. Good luck. And any question,
thank you, sir.
Out clarification required, call me anytime.
Thank you, sir.
I'm here to help you. Bye bye for the day. I'm a little exhausted. Water, lunch, everything is waiting. Thank you. Bye bye.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Bye bye.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.